Ladies and gentlemen, Pitch Talk proudly presents a full sit-down interview with a level 5 referee operating in Southern Amateur League and more. For 2 years, he was club secretary for a football club in Burn Oak. In April 2015, he was elected AFA Youth Council Chairman. His aims include having input on development and more.
To ask Darrell a question during our special interview, email pitchtalk@gmail.com and put Darrell David in the subject line. Pitch Talk meets Darrell David, coming soon.
The football talk show that holds back nothing on opinions.
Straight shooting LJA.
Hi, I'm John Sitton.
Grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
The G-Man.
Samir Sawney of Motivate Sports and Fitness.
Christian Carambeau.
Matt Hodgson, director of the 4-year plan.
We the people. For the people. Jazzy Fizzle.
Your Monday night football fix.
Make sure you join the revolution.
The pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk. Each and every Monday night of your lives
at youtube.com/pitchtalk.
For podcast links and information, check out our official website, www.pitch-talk.com.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
Grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Christian Carambeau.
Matt Hodgson, director of the 4-year plan.
Dave McLaughlin.
I'm Rob Lusher.
Andy Copeland from the Glenmet Southern Amateur League.
Philip Wick, I'm CEO of 14.
Former chairman of Ibis FC.
Chairman of Alexandra Park FC.
And you're listening.
And you're listening to Pitch Talk.
The only place to get your Monday night footballing fix.
Because the pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk. Make sure you join the revolution, the football revolution.
Hi, I'm John Sitton, and I'm here with Gavin, Liam, and Gerald on Pitch Talk.
The football talk show that pulls no punches and holds back nothing on opinions.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
My name is Christian Carambeau.
I'm grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Hi, I'm Matt Hodgson, director of the 4-year plan, and you're listening to Pitch Talk, the only place to get your Monday night footballing fix.
Make sure you join the revolution.
The pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk.
I'm Andy Copeland from the Glenmet Southern Amateur League.
Philip Wick, I'm CEO of 14.
I'm Rob Lusher, former chairman of Ibis FC.
I'm Samir Sawney, co-founder and co-director of Motivate Sports and Fitness.
And you're listening.
And you're listening to Pitch Talk.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, Straight Shooting LJA, the G-Man, and Jazzy Fizzle proudly bring to you the football talk show that pulls no punches and holds back nothing on opinions, because the pitch is where we eat. And the pitch is where we talk.
It was going so well.
So well until wham. Anyway.
Really? Already? No, that's brilliant. We're not even like 2-3 minutes into the show and already you went there.
Yeah, the Miguel thing kind of had to happen, man. That leg drop was legendary. The legendary leg drop. But we are your Monday Night Footballing Fix. www.pitch-talk.com is where you can find our official website. Find out everything Pitch Talk from our official website, www.pitch-talk.com. Also, facebook.com/pitchtalk. Become a fan, become a friend, become a member of the group. Join the footballing revolution we are working so hard to create. pitchtalk.blogspot.com or .co.uk will get you to the blogs. youtube.com/pitchtalk will get you to all of our videos including our Pitch Talk Meet series, our Pitch Talk on the Road series, and our Pitch Talk at the Cup Final series as well. Also, there are bits and bobs of past shows as well that make up the Pitch Talk Rants of the Week and our Push Points as well. Remember, get your questions in for Pitch Talk meets Darrell David. You heard at the top of the show how to get them in. PitchTalk@gmail.com and put Darrell David in the subject line. The chairman of the newly formed AFA, Amateur Football Alliance Youth Council, and also an AFA Lonsar member as well, Referees Association. Also, we do have Pitch Talk on the road at Hackney Wick FC coming soon. Keep your eyes peeled for that latest installment of the Pitch Talk on the Road series. We had a lot of fun, the three of us, down at Mabley Green.
Yes, we did.
We witnessed history. We witnessed this one. It was fantastic. But also must be said. Yes. 0753580466 is the mobile number. Call us, text us, let us know your views. Also, Pitch Talk One, we are on Skype. Pitch Talk One on Skype as well. As I said, if you're going to text us in on 0753580466, then leave your name at the end of the text so we can give you a shout out. We got a jam-packed show lined up tonight. But first of all, I'd like to also say big shout-outs to Beautiful Game 15 on Twitter, at Beautiful Game 15. That is Dan and Tom, two men in search of the Beautiful Game on Facebook. And also on Blogspot as well. I think it's beautifulgame15.blogspot.co.uk as well. I think it is, but it is one of them. Had to give them a massive shout out. Also, a big shout out to Hackney Wick FC as well, who this past weekend actually played against Alexandra Park FC. Little bit of a link in there with us as well. Our next Pitch Talk meets guest Darrell David actually saw a bit of that match because he was reffing a match afterwards at the same place. So it's, well, there was this little link there. Of course, there's a big time link between us and Alexandra Park FC. We were there for their kit launch back in 2013. And also, we actually bumped into Dave McLaughlin down at Hackney Wick FC as well, their chairman, who we had a Pitch Talk meets interview with as well. So big time shout out. All round. By the way, speaking of Hackney Wick FC, they actually do have a Hackney Derby coming up this week. It's Sporting Hackney FC versus Hackney Wick FC. So that should be very, very interesting. The beginning of a local rivalry. The beginning of a local derby. I like it. I don't like it. I love it. It's fantastic. Jersey Fizzle, how's your week and weekend been, man?
No, the week and weekend, you know what, right? I have to say, this week, yeah, has been absolutely phenomenal.
Okay.
Right, and let me preface that with a shout-out to everybody at work, you know what I mean, because you guys are amazing. Shout-out to GLG Inc., you know what I mean, because GLG is where it's at. Also, a big shout-out to my family, man. Love my family. Shout-out to my friends. Shout-out to my enemies. Shout-out to the frenemies as well. Obviously, have to give nothing but love to the ex-wife, nothing but love to the next wife, and of course, you know, my future kids, man. But one of the real interesting things that happened this week, right, I actually found out that Pitch Talk is actually going international, right? I didn't realize we were so popular.
I didn't realize we were so popular.
I mean, yes, we have fans all the way in Canada. Daniela and Guru are flying the flag for us over there. Thank you so much.
Fans in Ghana too as well.
Fans over in Florida, little Princess Bella, and of course my very good friend Sherry. Thank you so much for spreading the word as well. But you know what? You know what I found out, right? I found out that Pitch Talk is really, really, really popular in Wales.
You know what? Wait. Before you go on any further,
so I had no idea. I had no idea, right? So now I'm hearing about JE Productions. So I have to say, you know what? Big shout out to JE Productions, right? Because I wasn't aware of this booking, but apparently there's a Jersey Fizzle Sizzle tour, right? Coming to a neighborhood near you. next year.
Baby.
Right, next year. That's coming to you next year. And you know what? I think if we can line that up with like a pitch talk at the cup final for the Champions League final,
I said, baby,
that would be amazing. So I think we need to work on that. I think pitch talk, GLG Inc., SXC Productions, LJA Productions, apparently Rich Web Solutions. Yeah. Everybody needs to get involved. It's a collaboration thing, right? Because the other thing I was hearing was that there were some rates being applied and all the rest of it, right? And I'm thinking, surely it's better to share the wealth, right? Collaboration, cooperation, yeah? It's so much better than competition, right? We're not trying to, you know, compete with JE Productions and Entertainment. That's not it, yeah? We're talking about collaborations. So to the president and founder and chair lady of JE Productions and Entertainment, Jennifer Evans, thank you so much, right? And of course, understand this, what I'm really saying to you is, right, it's about making money together, yeah? Let's work as a team, right? Because here's the thing, last time I checked, this was grinding season, yeah? So I'm trying to make some money right now because, what, there's a Tory government, right? Middle class and poor people are struggling. Yeah, I'm just saying, help a brother out, and I help you out. That's what I'm saying. You help me, I help you. It's a mutually beneficial thing. Yeah? It's beneficial. Right? I'm like, you can get your piece of the pie, I get my piece of the pie. Hey, GLG gets their piece of the pie. Just saying. Just saying.
It all depends on the word pie. Sweet potato pie. Baby.
So yeah,
I don't really want to love you.
So, all I'm saying is this, right? JE Productions and Entertainment, holla at your boy. Okay, we'll work something out. Okay, we'll start an official Facebook group. Okay. That's just for Jazzy Fizzle, all right? So all of our fans over in Wales, they can join that group as well. All of our fans internationally, yeah? I'm talking all the way over in Canada, in the US. Let's go all the way over to Japan and China, all right? Everybody that's a fan of Jazzy Fizzle, join that group, all right? We'll be starting that group shortly. And, you know, just let me know. Let me know. We can do the damn thing. That's what I'm saying.
Wait. You do not want one night in China, apparently. Anyway, leaving that one aside... But probably what? That's the second OWR of the night. You do not want one night in China. Anyway, leaving that aside, it is one of them ones where that, yeah, man. It's like, baby. Jazzy's going to come and see ya.
Yeah, I'm making house calls. Making house calls.
The Jazzy Fizzle Sizzle Tour, baby. It's going to be happening.
That's what I'm saying. Right, it's a co-promotion, right? I know that JE Productions wants to go and take the lead on this one, but it's really a co-promotion. Yeah? Shout out to SXE, shout out to LGA Productions, shout out to Apparently Rich, and of course, it's all about GLG Inc. Yeah, GLG, that's what I'm saying.
The corporation will be taking over
in association with JE Productions and Entertainment. Can't forget JE, can't forget Jennifer Evans. So loud.
That's what that was. The G Man was big in Wales. Now Jazzy Fizzle's taking over Wales.
It's
a hostile takeover.
No. Here's the thing, right? I'm not trying to start a tough war. That's not what this is about.
It's a tough war.
Yeah.
Well, you're trying to make love, not war.
This is what I'm
saying. Baby, and I really want to love you when I look into your eyes.
Like I said, this is about love, man. So I'm not starting a tough war, but as we said, you know, you can hit up JE Productions and find out about that Jazzy Fizzle Sizzle tour. You can get your tickets. Yeah? Introductory rates do apply.
Bookings are being taken.
That's what I'm saying.
Special loyalty bonuses if you book 5 or more sessions.
That's what I'm saying. get your money's worth. That's what I'm saying. Hard times, man. Hard times.
Okay, Dusty. Hard times, Daddy.
Hard times, bro. That's all I'm saying.
See what they was hard times. They're going to be called Jazzy Fizzle Daddy. Is what they was. Hard times, Daddy.
You terrible. That's what I'm saying. No, no, seriously. Shout out to Jennifer. Thank you so much. And I'm looking forward to
one of your
insightful, debate-inspiring questions later on in tonight's show.
Definitely, definitely. Oh my God! Speaking of tonight's show, we do also have Russ Vernon and Tom Wood in the house. The G-Man, unfortunately, won't be able to make it. but you know what? It is one of them ones. We gotta get rowdy, rowdy, man. Yeah. PT click getting rowdy, rowdy. The PT family is rowdy, rowdy. The PT is just bout it, bout it. Oh, that one. I'm offending the Master P there. Anyway, about it, yo, I'm about it. But you know, a big time shout outs, as I said, to Hackney Wick FC. Big time shout outs to Jennifer Evans. Also, big shout outs to Russ Vernon and Tom Wood, who are in the Skype chat with us. And big shout out to those silent listeners too. Let us know if you're out there. Send us a tweet. Send us an FB message. Let us know. Big shout out to Mike Kahneman, Ryan Sonley, also Kieran Riley as well. So all good times there, Daddy. It is one of them ones. As I said, it is a case of let us know if you are listening. If you are listening live. But you know, without further ado, also wanted to give a big shout out to Girls on the Ball as well. Sophie and Rachel, big time shout outs. You know what? It's time for us to cut that music. Because it is time to go to the first segment of the show. A little deviation from usual. We're going to go into didn't feel like they're dropping any lyrics this week, probably because I didn't have any original ones. If you ain't gonna be original, there's no point. Curveball right open and strike one.
Well, you could have went, baby, I just want to love you.
Well, look at you.
Know,
just
that's Jesse Fizzle Sizzle Tour, brought to you by GLG Inc. and of course JE Productions Entertainment. Coming to a neighborhood near you, baby.
Oh, it's one of them ones. You know what? Where we are going to go first. Women's FA Cup final, Wembley set for record crowd. This is from July 16th, 2015. A record crowd is expected for this year's Women's FA Cup final on August 1st after the Football Association revealed 24,000 tickets have been sold for the showpiece. I said this is as of the 16th of July 2015. Wembley Stadium will host the final for the first time, and the current attendance record is 24,582, set at Nottingham Forest City Ground in 2008. This year's final, which is live on BBC, will be contested between Chelsea ladies and Notts County ladies. In November, England women made history. when they played Germany in their first match at the National Stadium, drawing a crowd of 45,619. The FA says that while the full 90,000 ground capacity will be available for the final, the aim is to attract a crowd of at least 34,000, which will fill the lower bowl. We're pretty confident that we're going to exceed that record. Kate Brazier, head of women's leagues and competitions at the FA, told BBC Sport, I have no doubt we'll have issued well in excess of that, and hopefully we'll be hitting our 34,000 target. Last season, 15,098 fans saw Arsenal lift the trophy at Stadium NK, but Brazier said England's third place finish at the Women's World Cup has increased demand for tickets. The attendance for the 2013 final at the Keepmoat Stadium was 4,988 as Arsenal beat Bristol Academy 3-0. That was also broadcast to BBC as well, I think. But we've seen a great uplift following the success of the Lionesses in Canada. Their success has put women's football on the map, and people are realizing it's a great product to watch. That was proved last weekend with the WSL attendances, which we mentioned last week, which were right up on previous years with crowds at several of the grounds over 2,000. The FA says making Wembley the permanent home for the Women's FA Cup final is part of their long-term plans, and that next year's event will also be held there. That's good stuff. Staying with women's football, Germany's Celia Sasic retires from football. This is also from Thursday, 16th of July, 2015. So, two interesting ones. I'm looking forward to many new things, said Celia Sasic after retiring at 27 as reigning UEFA Women's Champions League and FIFA Women's World Cup top scorer. Germany strikers Celia Sasic announced her retirement at the age of 27. She should be retiring from football completely. Sasic was top scorer in last season's UEFA Women's Champions League, which FFC Frankfurt won. And yeah, she cited new challenges for the decision to hang up her boots. She said, I'm looking forward to many new things in my life, my university studies, a new orientation job-wise, and starting a family, among many other things, explained Celia Sasic. A UEFA Women's Euro 2009 and 2013 winner, the 111 cap forward, took the 2015 World Cup Golden Boot with 6 goals as her nation finished 4th. Sasic, on target 63 times at senior international level, scored a record equaling 4 team in Frankfurt's UEFA Women's Champions League campaign last term, including the opener in the 2-1 defeat at Paris Saint-Germain in Berlin. During my 11 years in the Women's Bundesliga and over 10 years in the national team, I had some unforgettable experiences and was part of an amazing development, which makes me proud, said Sasic, who has been working as an ambassador for integration for the German Football Association, DFB, and as a development assistant for girls and women's football. Fantastic stuff. Sylvia Knight, the Germany coach, has said, I regret Celia's decision, but I can understand it as well. Football is not everything in life, and there comes a point when you have to set other priorities. For us, it's a huge loss because Celia is an outstanding personality, leaving behind huge footprints. She was always a role model on and off the pitch. On and off the pitch. Milan Sasic, her father-in-law and experienced coach, says Celia is a wonderful woman with an unbelievable positive charisma. She has a social mindset, is always helpful and sympathetic, a real ray of sunshine. Colin Bell, the Frankfurt coach, said Celia is a forward who likes to score goals and puts in a high work rate defensively as well. Her determination to always deliver 100% for the team is a superb quality. Also, Frankfurt Alemeng Zeitung, Celia Sasic is one of the faces of women's football in Germany. She unites many cultures in one person. Once she has the ball at her feet, she will most often look for the straightest path towards goal. That's why the name Sasic ranks very high up in the statistics of women's football in Germany. So, one end and potentially one new beginning. So, it's very, I find this interesting. I mean, it was a bolt out of the blue, actually. I think even Steph Houghton, actually, the England Lionesses captain, actually tweeted out and said, well, that was a surprise that Sasic would retire at 27. But it is one of them ones where, yeah, there are some things, in the words of Jersey Fizzle, that are bigger than football. And obviously, Celia Sasic switching to her studies, which is always, it's always good to have something to fall back on. So it's one of them was a lot of players retire and they don't have anything to do. So they slip into dangerous habits and that kind of thing. So it's really good to see that Celia Sasic not only, well, not only is retiring early at the top of her game, really, but also is looking at other things, starting a family and looking at other priorities that she has. So I think it's a good thing. I mean, coming back to the Women's FA Cup final, which of course all three co-hosts of your Monday Night Footballing Fix will be at on August 1st, and we'll be there with the cameras as well. It is one of them ones where it is fantastic to see 24,000 tickets have already been sold, and this was 16th of July, so that was 4 days ago. If you haven't got yours, get to the fa.com/ticketing and you can get yours right now if you wanted to. But yeah, it is fantastic to see that 24,000 people getting behind the two sides, Chelsea ladies and Notts County ladies. It should be a good match. I mean, if the weekend's FAWSL matches or anything that go by, they actually should be pretty good. So here's one of them. Was Jersey Fizzle, your views, and if the Skypers want to jump in as well, let us know.
Yeah, I mean, it's wonderful news about the tickets so far. I mean, the only disappointment is what? I think Wembley holds, what? Isn't it like 70,000 or something?
I think it's 90.
See, well, there you go. 90, yeah. Right, so there's 70,000 to go, more or less, in my opinion. So I'm thinking, why is it, right, that the men, and this is my thing that I've been talking about the last few weeks, why is it that the men can essentially fill the stadium when essentially, let's be honest, they've been underwhelming for a very long time, right? And players that have represented a England team that went to third place in this year's Women's World Cup, right? Can't get more people to come down. I do not understand it. Now, here's my thing. I honestly believe that the FA could, should, and hopefully will do more in terms of marketing the women's games at Wembley to get the crowds. Because here's the thing. People want it. If you just look at the views of the games in terms of the raw numbers, right? Didn't this year's World Cup have the highest views?
Yeah, it was shattering records. I mean, you had at least 2-3 million per game watching.
So really, there are people that want to see this. I really think it's a marketing thing. You know, maybe they can speak to JE Productions, get some hints and tips. You know, I mean, obviously, the cup final isn't quite the Fizzle Sizzle tour, but, you know, the same principle applies here. You know, I would love to see it reach, you know, at least the 40,000 mark. At least, right? Because if women's football is going to grow how I feel that it will grow and should grow over the coming years, that's exactly what it means. Right? If the FA Cup in the men's game can be sold out or pretty much close to sold out, I'm saying the women really shouldn't be that far behind.
Well, in theory, not that far behind. But then we got to look at the marketing machines that have been put behind.
No, and games, that's what so, I said. That's yeah, why I'm that's, saying that, you know, they can go speak to JE Productions because, you know, it's really a matter of getting the right marketing machine behind it. You know, and as I said, I honestly believe that the FA can, should, and hopefully will do much more because the women's game deserves that, right? Much like grassroots. I mean, here's the thing. I think EE are sponsoring some YouTubers playing a game at Wembley, right? So if EE can do that, and really, let's be honest, who's that bothered about these YouTubers actually playing football, when actual football, yeah, when they're more famous for playing FIFA?
Yeah.
Right? Then why not have EE get behind the Women's FA Cup final and League Cup final?
No, among other,
you know, potential sponsors. Because here's the bit, that's and no disrespect to those YouTubers, I'm a fan of some of those YouTubers, but that's real.
Yeah, no, I'm totally with you on that. I mean, me personally, I don't get the gimmick of, I know it's big business and I'm not disrespecting it, but I don't really get the gimmick of sitting down and watching someone else play a game. I'd much rather play it myself. I might have that kind of thing on alongside, but I want to play the game myself. But that's just me. But at the end of the day, I would much rather play football than watch it. And that's just me. But a lot of people are into it. But I think them kind of that's what frustrates me. The kind of energy and marketing machines put behind those people, those YouTubers going to play a match. It's why not put that behind the women's game? That's where the discrepancy. Yeah, that's a frustrating thing. Saying. Yeah, it's one of them ones. But there's a lot in the footballing world that I don't get. So,
But on to Celia Sasic's retirement, you know, and I have to say a big thank you to her, because obviously she's given us a big part of her life over the last 10, 11 years, which is a long time when you consider that she is only 27, and she's been a phenomenal talent. You know, in terms of, you know, pretty much winning all that there is to win, at least domestically, and doing very, very well internationally, you know, that's what she's done. And you have to tip your hat to that kind of player, regardless, you know, irrespective of whether it's a man or a woman. And the mere fact that, you know, she's essentially leaving football to go and take on new challenges, as she put it, that are, in my opinion, bigger than football, like, you know, continuing an education, starting a family, amongst other things, you know, you have to respect that.
Of course.
You have to respect that. And at the same time, as I say, you know, I feel honored to have watched that play, at least for Germany. You know, because as I say, to me, she was a great player, absolutely fierce finisher in the box, and, you know, an inspiration, not just for me, but I think for other young women looking to get into football, to show them what you can actually do, you know. And I'll put other players, contemporaries like Abby Wambach in that as well, who also retired.
Yeah.
So, you know, for me, as I say, it was absolutely tremendous. Thank you to Celia Sasic for everything that she's done in the women's game. And, you know, I wish her nothing but the best of everything else.
You know what? I couldn't have put much more of a finer point on it myself. I mean, it is one of them ones where it is fantastic to see that she's done it on her own terms, rather than being, say, forced out with an injury or age has caught up and that kind of thing. So it is one of them ones. It is good to see someone bow out on their own terms and because of positive reasons, rather than negative reasons. Just like, say, Hackney Wick FC, the way they started up, they've started up because basically for a positive reason rather than in reaction to a negative. So I think that's good. I mean, if any of the Skypers want to jump in, let us know. But yeah, I mean, I said it is one of those. It's good to see that. I mean, essentially, you could see this as kind of two new beginnings, really, with the Women's FA Cup final being at Wembley and also Sasic retiring to basically focus on other things. So it's always good. I think it's always good in that way. I mean, Russ Vernon, you wanted to jump in, Colin?
It's about mainly about the FA Women's Cup final.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think if he's a success this season, this time at Wembley Stadium, I think the next 5 or 10 years FA Women's Cup finals will be at Wembley, like the men's. I think every year they'll probably pull the Women's Cup final at Wembley to success this year, because a lot more fans will probably end up going to it. A lot more fans will end up probably watching it more with being in the National Stadium. Probably get quite sold out if more and more people watch the women's game and watch the Women's FA Cup. If they enjoy the World Cup, we'll probably start watching the women's game more and probably get more fans through the gate to Wembley than if they say if they all did other grounds like Boreham Wood, for example, if they played in one there, I think, one season. I think if they play there, they won't get many fans, but if they go to Wembley, they'll get many fans, or they'll get more viewers, more fans through the gates, more revenue in life into the competition, and it'll be better for the women's game and women's football in general.
Well, at least they've got next year's one, which has already been said is going to be at Wembley as well. So at least there's that, which is kind of in the book already. So I mean, it is one of them ones to help the growth of the women's game. I think it's nothing but a good thing. I really do think it's nothing but a good thing. So I like it. I actually really like it as an initiative. It's one of them ones. I mean, the word respect was mentioned. And of course, I like that was mentioned as well. But one thing that some would say would be the opposite of respect is disrespect. And we're going to start in terms of transfers, we're going to start off with a little bit of that, because Neil Redfern, Leeds United coach, resigns from academy position. This is from 16th of July 2015. Former Leeds head coach Neil Redfern has resigned as academy boss, claiming the club made his position untenable. Redfern, who's 49 years old, was replaced as a championship-sized boss by Uwe Rosler in May. He accepted the offer to return to his previous role with the club's academy, but said in a statement that the offer was not genuine and the club refused to let him take up the position. Leeds told BBC Radio Leeds that they were not planning to issue a statement at the time. Redfern said, "I would like to, however, place on record my thanks to everyone connected with the first team, including the fans, for making last season both productive and beneficial after a difficult start. Very importantly, I would like to pay a special tribute to the academy where I proudly worked along with others for the best part of 6 years. I would like to wish Uwe Rosler and the staff and players every success for next season and beyond so that Leeds can get back to the Premier League very soon. Last but not least, I wish to thank the fans for their unstinting support during both during my time at the academy and whilst in charge of the first team." The former Barnsley midfielder initially joined the club's academy in January 2009 and spent time in caretaker charge in September 2014 before being appointed head coach in November. He won 11 of his 33 matches at the helm, but it always seemed likely that he would not retain the position beyond the end of the season after his assistant Steve Thompson was suspended in April. Thompson since left the club for Preston. Now, moving on in terms of transfer, Stuart Downing returning home. Winger Stuart Downing has rejoined his hometown club, Middlesbrough, on a four-year deal, stepping down the division from Premier League side West Ham. The 30-year-old will join, at the time, was going to join the club's Marbella training camp last Friday after completing a deal worth £5.5 million that could rise to £7 million if Middlesbrough are promoted. Downing, who's been capped 35 times by England, left the Riverside for Aston Villa in July 2009 before moving to Liverpool and then on to West Ham. Eunice Kabul, Tottenham defender, joined Sunderland. You want to talk about a U-turn? This is one of them. Because a few years ago, he said he wouldn't join Sunderland. But anyway, Sunderland have signed Tottenham defender Eunice Kabul on 16th of July 2015 for an undisclosed fee. The move comes 7 years after the Frenchman's agent said his client wouldn't join Sunderland even if there was an earthquake. I haven't seen no earthquake, but still. Meanwhile, Sunderland defender Santiago Virginie has joined Spanish side Getafe on a season-long loan deal. The 26-year-old Argentine had joined the Black Cats from Estudiantes in 2014, and his move to Getafe is with a view to a permanent switch. Jordi Klaasi, Southampton signed Holland midfielder. Southampton on the 15th of July 2015 signed Holland midfielder Jordi Klaasi from Feyenoord for a fee in the region of £8 million. Klaasi, who has agreed a five-year deal with the Premier League club, worked under Saints boss Ronald Koeman at Feyenoord, where he played 129 games. He's 24 years old and has 11 caps for his country, with part of the squad that finished third at the 2014 World Cup. That came 2 days after Morgan Schneiderlin's £25 million move to Manchester United. Speaking of Manchester, Fabian Delph joined Manchester City from Aston Villa. Man City completed the signing of Fabian Delph for £8 million after the England midfielder changed his mind about leaving Aston Villa. This is from the 18th of July 2015. The 25-year-old, who's been capped 6 times by his country, completed his medical last Friday and flew out to Australia to join his new teammates on their pre-season tour. There's quite a bit more to be said in terms of Fabian Delph and the ensuing saga, we must say, because, well, there was quite a lot. I mean, Friday, 10th of July 2015, having featured in an Aston Villa tweet promoting next season's new kit earlier that day, a lot of media outlets learned that the England midfielder was set to have a medical at Manchester City after they actually triggered the £8 million release clause. Now, it is one of them ones where some football followers actually keenly pointed out Delph's comments when he signed a new 4.5-year contract with Villa in January, which said, "There was no way I was going to bail out. I am here for the long run." Now, on the 11th, Delph released a statement through the Villa website saying that he has confirmed he will be remaining at the club and leading the team into the new season. He was quoted as saying by the Villa website, "I'm aware there has been intense media speculation surrounding my future in the last 24 hours, and I want to set the record straight. I'm not leaving. I'm staying at the football club, and I can't wait for the start of the season and captaining this great football club." Although some questioned his decision to turn down the move to a bigger club, other football fans like certain fans, including Arsenal supporter Stephen Parkhill, praised the decision to stay put, and so did we initially. Fabian Delph has rejected Man City move to stay at Aston Villa. Fair play to Delph opting for a career over money. That was from Stephen Parkhill at Parky_92. Now, Tuesday, 14th of July, Delph flew out to join the rest of his teammates at their Portugal training camp. Now, that squad had been strengthened by the signing of Idrissa Gueye, Scott Sinclair, and Michael Richards. Keep Michael Richards in mind. Christian Benteke at the time was a target for Liverpool and travelled with the club. Getting on to Benteke in a second. But it is one of them was Villa manager Tim Sherwood at that time said, "I knew there was interest from Manchester City and a few other clubs who had shown a lot of interest in Fabian, as I expected, for such a small fee on the buyout clause, but he never indicated to me that he wanted to leave." But Friday, 17th of July, the second twist came. Delph had a change of heart. Rumours that he was set to make a U-turn and join Man City surfaced early on Friday, when a picture kind of was leaked out of him looking like he was going to a medical. So it was one that was, it was understood that Delph had informed club owner Randy Lerner of his latest decision on Thursday. So this is basically 6 days after he said he was staying put. But by Friday evening, it was all over. And boy, he was holding that shirt up in one of the changing rooms at Manchester City, clad in Manchester City gear. And he is now a Manchester City player. £8 million, pretty damn cheap. But another Villa departure that we're waiting for confirmation on. But Christian Benteke, Aston Villa striker, was set for Liverpool medical. This from 19th of July 2015. Striker Christian Benteke was due to have a medical at Liverpool today, Monday 20th of July 2015, after they reached an agreement with Aston Villa over a £32.5 million transfer. So, Benteke joined Villa from Gonk in 2012 for £7 million, and he scored 49 goals in 101 games. Benteke, who still has 2 years left on his Villa contract, scored 12 goals in 12 games last season to help Tim Sherwood's side avoid relegation from the top flight. Liverpool made a move for the striker after receiving funds from the £49 million sale of Raheem Sterling to Premier League rivals Manchester City. Now, just as the song comes to an end, it's tremendous. Now, stop, pause, and wait a minute. Jersey Fizzle, you want to jump in? And Skypers, if you want to jump in as well, let us know.
Sure. I'll start with the potential move for Benteke. I think he'll be a very, very good signing for Liverpool, if that's where he does go. Personally, I would have loved to have seen him at Manchester United. No, because I think he would add something different, especially now that Robin Van Persie is no longer at the club. But I think it's a signing Liverpool need, you know, to have a real focal point in the attack, especially with all of the changes. And he offers something different for Liverpool, you know, especially if, for example, Mario Balotelli is to be moved on. So I think that would be, you know, a really useful signing. But I have to preface what I'm about to say with, there's no loyalty. There's no loyalty on either side, right? The clubs aren't loyal. The players aren't loyal. Fans aren't even loyal so much anymore. There's no loyalty. There's no loyalty, right? But my biggest thing about the Fabian Delph move, right? I'm like this. Just say, yeah, you're flattered, you're thinking about it, you know, it's a big decision to make in your professional and personal life, you know, but don't say all the things that everybody would love for you to say, i.e. no, I'm not going, I'm staying, I can't wait to lead the team out next season, I'm so happy to be playing for this, you know, wonderful football club, blah, blah, blah. Only to then, well, I suppose, defecate the same words, right? When you're away having a medical signing deal anyway, after you said, no, I'm not going to go. Holding up the scarf, you know, clad in the kit like you're John Terry. Because that, to me, that's the most heartbreaking thing, right? If he had said, look, you know, it's something I seriously have to consider for my footballing future, then okay, right? Like, no one's really going to hate on him for the fact that, look, here's the thing. How many times as a player do you have the potential opportunity to play in the Champions League? Not many. Not many. Right? How many times do you get to play for a team that has a real chance of competing for several trophies? Not many. Right? So I can't hold that bit against him. The bit that I personally hold against him, even though I'm not a Villa fan, even though I'm not really a fan of his, is just the bit where he sold everybody a story.
Yeah.
That's what it was. Mm. I mean, if you know how we were talking about the marketing for the women's game earlier?
Yeah.
Really, they should take a lesson from Fabian Delph.
Oh, good Lord. Yeah, he's hey, it's one of them ones. He must be friends with Vince Russo because that was quite a swerve.
It was the old bait and switch because I'm like, I just feel he didn't need to do it. That's my view. Mm. He didn't need to do it. Just be honest and say, look, I'm a swayed, right? Mm. It's not every time that I'll have an opportunity to play with a great player like Yaya Toure, African Player of the Year 4 years in a row.
Rumor has it is that Delph was annoyed by the selling, by the potential selling of Benteke. But that's one rumor that has popped up.
Which I understand. I do get that, right? But so with that annoyance, he decides, right, well, I'll just leave anyway.
Well, that's kind of cutting your nose off to spite your face, really.
And that's my thing.
Especially
so annoyed, and you decide, right, well, if he might go, then I'm definitely going to go. What?
Yeah, it's one of them ones. Looking at a big shout out to resident Villa supporter and PT family member who we met on Wembley Way, and that was Matt Plant, who at one point was at, yep. When you're on a Pitch Talk video saying that Fabian Delph is going to be a big player next season, and then he goes to Man City.
Yeah, but kiss of death.
Yeah, but that was before the swerve. That was legitimately before the swerve. So it was a case of, as I said, Fabian Delph must be friends with Vince Russo, because that swerve was something that no one expected and no one understood either. For me, the fact of the matter is, as you said, Jazzy, I don't mind the fact, yeah, if you want to play Champions League football, yeah, fine. That's all well and good. There ain't nothing wrong with that.
If you want to play with a great player like Yaya Toure, fine.
Yeah, there ain't nothing wrong with that. But it's just
no qualms with that, yeah, whatsoever.
But it's the way that he's gone about it. If I was a Villa fan, I'd be looking at Fabian Delph and be wanting to say this.
If I wanted crap out of you, I'll pick it out of your teeth.
That's all that come out of his mouth.
Yeah.
That's the truth of it. Now, the other part of it for me is this, right? Did he not see what happened to Jack Rodwell?
Scott Sinclair.
Did you not see what happened to Scott Sinclair, who left Manchester City to join Aston Villa?
There's even more of an irony in it, though, because apparently...
And, of course, Michael Richards.
Yeah, you know what? There's an irony within that, because apparently Michael Richards... Well, see, this is the thing with the conflicting reports that were coming out of this story. Because at one point, Michael Richards was like, no, I persuaded Delph out of going to Man City. Then it came out a couple days ago that it, and a few days later, that it was like, No. Micah Richards. Micah Richards had persuaded me to go to Manchester City. And it's like, dude, which is it? You can't be both. You can't be half pregnant. It's either you are or you ain't. It's either he did or he didn't. Once again, you got to say the Fabian Delph.
If I want any crap out of you, I'll pick it out of your teeth.
Because he, for me, has literally sold a bill of goods. And I find it absolutely hilarious. Because at the end of the day, that's Villa's captain. That's Villa's captain who's going on like that. This ain't, say, a Raheem Sterling, who's one of the supposed main players, but is not the captain. It's one of them. Imagine, say, a Steven Gerrard doing that to Liverpool. That would have been one of them ones. There would have been huge uproar. And the Aston Villa fans, including Pitch Talk's own Matt Plant, must have been thinking,
I don't know what the hell is going on here.
Wait a minute.
But I don't like it at all.
They must have been, the Villa fans must have been thinking that. Because the way Delph has gone on about it is not on. The Benteke deal now, it's one of them was, it looks like Aston Villa are getting strip mined for their best players at the moment.
Yeah.
I mean,
if that had something to do with it, if the potential leaving of Benteke had something to do with it, I can understand that. But that's still
a cheap cop-out. That's your captain.
No, it's a cheap cop-out. But I'm saying, here's the thing, right? Why not say something like, you're considering it because you can see that the club are trying to cash in on other players, right? That's understandable. Because look, let's face it, right? Versus like, say, for example, challenging for the Premier League. We know Aston Villa's not going to do that.
Of course not.
Okay? Anybody who's been paying attention for the last few years know Aston Villa aren't going to do that. Will they be safe? Could they be, you know, low and mid-table? Potentially.
Yeah.
Will they challenge? No. And that's just me being blunt. And look, if I've upset some Villa fans, I'm sorry, but take your medicine. Right? But the whole is it ain't thing with Fabian Delph, look, you're just wasting my time.
There's a Tame Impala reference in there. Why won't you make up your mind? Give me a sign. Am I wasting my time and aching my head?
What I'm trying to say about this,
of course.
Right? If he just came out and said, yeah, look, I'm swayed by the money, I want to go, fine. And here's the other thing. It's so obvious that Manchester City are trying to fulfill their homegrown quota, right? But I asked this question. As good as Fabian Delph has been last season, both in a Villa shirt and in an England shirt, right?
He's not Man City.
Is he actually
caliber.
Kicking out? Who's he kicking out of that midfield?
Yeah, not exactly.
In a central position. Yeah. Yaya Toure is not going anywhere.
Yeah, not exactly.
Right? Arguably, you'd say now, David Silva plays centrally. He's definitely not kicking out David Silva. Mm. That's not happening.
Yeah.
Right? If you wanted to put Sami Nasri in the middle, he's not kicking out Sami Nasri.
Mm.
Right? Where does he think this playing time is coming from? Unless he's happy to play cup games.
Mm.
And that's it. Maybe step up if there's an injury. Yeah. Because that's the only playing time I really see him getting. Let's be honest.
Yeah. I mean, this whole thing with Fabian Delph, I said it did make me think of this Tame Impala tune. It legitimately made me think of this tune. But so anyways, wait for the drop. It just literally reminded me of that tune.
The other part of it is this, right? You famously said on the show on more than one occasion, those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. And I've seen that in my own life. So I know that that's true.
Yeah.
I know that that's real. And here's the thing, right? You look at the likes of a Jack Rodwell, who you're thinking, yeah, you know what? When he played for Everton, very good player.
Look at the hype.
It's highly likely that he's going to get game time. No. Let me repeat that. No. Let me just say this in a different way. It didn't happen.
Yeah.
He fizzled out. And I'm not even talking about this fizzle sizzle tour. Because that's going on for a long time.
Baby!
What I mean is, in terms of those homegrown players at Manchester City, have they had a long shelf life? No, they haven't. Right? There's always been a significant upgrade and replacement. James Milner just left, and he was arguably one of their better players in the last few years. And why did he leave? Lack of playing time. What does Fabian Delph think he's going to get that's going to be different at Manchester City for him specifically?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I mean, the funny thing is, the week before, we were concerned with that in regards to Raheem Sterling.
Exactly. Now that, and that focus still applies to Raheem Sterling. Yeah. That hasn't gone anywhere.
Yeah.
Right. So, my thing is, here's the thing. If he's saying to me on a level, listen, bro, it's about the money, yeah? As you said earlier, there's a Tory government. Shout out to George the Poet, by the way, with his cover on the Live Lounge of 31 and Trap Queen. Brilliant cover, by the way. If you haven't heard it, listen to it now. Tell them I sent you, right? But seriously, I understand that, as I say, in terms of sports people, the window to make as much money as possible is very small. I get that. Tell me it's about the money. Fine. Tell me that you want to be a passenger and maybe collect a winner's medal or two. Fine.
But don't sell me a bill of goods. Be honest about it.
That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
It's one that
Why are you flirting? I know that you care, you know. But seriously, there's just no need.
Yeah.
There's literally no need. Here's the thing, right? The biggest thing for Raheem Sterling now in terms of his image, and the even bigger thing now for Fabian Delph, the fans don't respect you. Yeah? They don't believe in you no more.
Yeah, but then again, Raheem Sterling and Fabian Delph are probably gonna go on if someone was to say that to him. Oh, the fans don't respect you anymore. They probably go on like Bret Hart. Probably go on like that Bret Hart promo in 97. The fact of the matter is, you don't respect me. Well, you know what? I don't respect you.
Hear that too.
Because it's one. I love the fact that Raheem Sterling recently has been like, yeah, I kind of regret the way things have gone down.
That made me laugh.
And it's like,
that
yeah.
That made me laugh.
It's like, yeah,
right?
I'm cool with Liverpool.
You know what you do? You don't do things that way.
Yeah. But it's
deal with it like a man, straight up.
Yeah, but this is the thing. This is the thing. Selling the fans, selling the club a bill of goods. I think the Delph one was worse because that is their captain. That is your captain. Legitimately switching 6 days. 6 days. We ain't building up to no WWE pay-per-view, and this ain't Monday Night Raw. This is your Monday Night Football and Fixed Pitch Talk. We ain't building up to no pay-per-view on Sunday. We're 6 days away. No. 6 days away from a swerve. It's like 6 days away from a mug-off. Nobody wants to be on the receiving end of a mug-off, whether it's 1 day away, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It doesn't really matter. The fact of the matter is, Delph mugged off not only the fans, but he mugged off Aston Villa, the club. If he was fuming at the Benteke sale, hey, so what? Life sucks and then you die. It's one of them, to quote Vince McMahon with that one. Life sucks and then you die. You move on. You're the captain. You're supposed to be leadership by example. You were one of the players who not just the fans, but the club wanted to build upon, who Tim Sherwood wanted to build upon. You can't be going on like that, because literally you ain't just burning bridges. You are bridge over the river, quiet, straight up. Boom. You're torching, demolishing bridges. You ain't burning them. You're literally just detonating. You're going on like Jim Cornette. Thank you, F you, bye. It's one of them ones. You may as well have done that on your way out. And it's ironic that it's two young players doing this within the space of a week of each other. For me, there's a little bit of an irony there. And it's one of them ones. It's the irony that it's two English players. There's the irony that it's two doing earlier. But it's just absolutely crazy. But coming back to the Benteke one. Benteke, fact of the matter is, very good player. I'm just hoping that if he does come to Liverpool, I'll be happy about it. But obviously, my concern is that it's 32 and a half million. There will be comparisons with Andy Carroll. Obviously, Benteke, I think, is significantly better than Andy Carroll. And he's had, what, three good seasons behind him in terms of being consistent, rather than Andy Carroll, who basically, before he came to us, had half a season in the Premier League and was a knee-jerk reaction player. But the fact of the matter is, the one thing we've got to do with Benteke, and it's those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat it, as Jazzy Fizzle mentioned earlier. It is a case of we've got to make sure that if we do buy Benteke, we service him properly. That's the one major thing, because you can't be spending that much on a player and not serving them properly. Yeah, we bought Stuart down into service Andy Carroll on the pitch, nothing wrong. But it didn't work. What, one season, no goals, no assists? And it's like, okay, you are a fat load of a boatload of wasted money. But leaving that aside, it is a case of we got to learn from that history. I think Benteke is better on the deck than Andy Carroll was, but his strength does not lie on the deck. And that's one of the key things for me. His goal scoring record of pretty much a goal every other game is a very good record. I'm just hoping that Benteke doesn't turn into, say, a Darren Bent, where for a little club where everything is running through him, Darren Bent, Charlton, he's doing brilliantly. But then when you step him up to a bigger club, competing in Europe, trying to compete for the title, it's one of them ones. Hopefully it's not one of them ones where he kind of fizzles out, really, like Darren Bent did at Tottenham. Hopefully not, anyway. But I don't mind the Benteke purchase, but obviously there is huge amount of risk involved. Jordi Klaassi, going from Feyenoord to Southampton for 8 million. It's a nice little bit of business by Southampton, in all honesty, because at the end of the day, they've snapped someone up on the cheap. And again, Southampton is a very good breeding ground for players. Very good place to go and develop. Yunus Kabul joining Sunderland. As mentioned earlier, you want to talk about U-turn. You want to talk about a U-turn? Yeah, that was one. And I'm not even referring. Okay. I'm not even referring, or at least I'm not referring yet, to the Usher tune, U-turn. I mean, it was one of them ones that it seems to be that U-turns. It just seems to be that U-turns seem to be the thing to do at the moment. I don't know why. I don't know how, but it seems to be in vogue to do it. But yeah. Yo. This is what I was thinking. Yo. It's time to U-turn. This is what I was thinking.
You heard me? You either with us or against us.
You want a little one. It's been some years. But you know what? You know one of them was where you're just thinking to yourself that is it in vogue at the moment? Oh, come on! It ain't hard to learn. Footballers are doing a U-turn. Bend your knees, go from Aston Villa to Man City. Oh, Fabian Delph and Yunus Kabul. See, that's what I'm thinking. And yeah, the impromptu singing, I just had to do it. But the fact of the matter is, you got these players doing U-turns and just really mugging it off. Stuart Downing returning home, you might as well say, to Middlesbrough. Very good deal for Middlesbrough. I think that's a very good deal for Middlesbrough. Experienced player going into that squad can only bolster what Middlesbrough are doing. The Neil Redfern thing, that's hilarious. But at the same time, it's not totally unexpected. It is not totally. It's one of them was the offer not being genuine to return to the academy. That's just hilarious to me. Remember, you still got a two-time fraudster running the club. So that's why it wasn't unexpected. So I don't know, man. The whole thing with Neil Redfern, I think Neil Redfern got, once again, he got mugged off again. I mean, we got to bear in mind, a year ago, he got sacked after three games. What, you ain't learned your lesson yet? You got sacked after three games, then you got rehired, then basically you got told, see you later, we don't need you anymore, we got someone else in, and you got offered your former position. I think Redfern really should have seen it coming, considering what happened last year. He really should have seen this coming. And those who don't learn from the past, hey, are doomed to repeat it. I'll say that one again. Jazzy Fizzle, you want to jump in on the other transfers and the Neil Redfern thing before we throw it to the Skype?
Well, the Neil Redfern thing, here's the thing. I really don't know what is going on at Leeds. I don't think anybody at Leeds knows what's going on at Leeds. And that's why there's all of this turnaround. And, you know, you mentioned the interesting point about respect. Okay, this is a guy that stepped up to the plate for the club on multiple levels, right? So you'd expect the club would, you know, at least offer him some kind of backative, at least. But no. There's none whatsoever. So, I don't know. I look at it like this, right? If you're a coach, I'd say stay away from Leeds.
Yeah, poison.
If you're a manager, stay away from Leeds. Just because until that place is gutted in terms of the infrastructure regarding management, I just don't see anything positive there. Mm. I really don't. I'm sorry. And I know that's a terrible thing to say, and I'm well aware of that, but as I said, I just can't see it. Mm. I just can't see it. There isn't a lot there for me personally to be particularly excited about. But I will say this, Jordy Clarcy going to Southampton to go and work with Ronald Koeman again, very shrewd signing. And if we're just talking about the 25 million that they got for Schneiderlin from Manchester United,
yeah,
right? There's still 17 million in the bank.
Exactly.
For other moves, if they're being allowed to spend all of that money. So if they are, I say it's a brilliant move. Jordy Clarcy, he's been referred to as the Dutch Xavi.
Well,
he's been compared to.
I don't know if I'd put much stock into that after Joe Allen was called the Welsh Xavi.
Well, yeah.
See, them comparisons always fall down somewhere, I'm just saying.
But yeah, I think, as I say, in terms of, you know, having a deeper line playmaker, someone who can really link everything, brilliant signing. And personally, I'm looking forward to him playing in the Premier League. Saw him a couple of times in the Eredivisie, was very, very impressed. Saw him for the Netherlands a couple of times, again, very impressed. So looking forward to seeing what he does on a regular basis in the Premier League for Southampton. Younis Kaboul, I'd say, I hope you've changed agents, right? Because that whole thing, absolutely hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. I will say nothing more on that because it literally writes itself. But one of my favourite stories has to be Stuart Downing going back to Middlesbrough. That's one of my favourites, right? Because we were talking before about loyalty, and I said, and I prefaced everything that I said about players not being loyal, clubs not being loyal, managers not being loyal, fans not being loyal. That's loyalty right there. That's what that is. For him to have gone back there when there are far more lucrative deals on offer for him, he could have stayed in the Premier League if he wanted to. He could have even gone abroad if he wanted to, but he decided he's going back to his hometown and his hometown club where it all started. Now, to kind of paraphrase Jake, he started from the bottom and now he's back there.
He got homesick.
Right? But, you know, I just think you don't see enough of that. I think another sort of comparison would be Carlos Tevez going back to Boca Juniors.
Yeah, no, I'll go with that.
But as I say, I just thought it's a really heartwarming thing to see that. And it really wasn't about the transfer fee, in my opinion. it was about going home. And to paraphrase Drake again, he held on and now he's going home.
No, I'll go with that. I mean, for me, the fact, one of the major things, and by the way, Arturo Vidal has actually left Juventus earlier today as well. Just thought I'd mention that in terms of transfer. But it is one of them ones where players going home is always an interesting one. I mean, Tevez ended up as somewhat of a journeyman, but he pretty much picked up every trophy on his way. So a worthwhile journey, it must be said. But it is one of them ones. I mean, you got moves happening all over the place. I said Arturo Vidal moved to Bayern Munich for £28 million. And apparently Juve are in talks to sign Julian Draxler as a replacement. So thought I'd mention that one as well. But for me, you got a lot of these kind of big money moves. But it's funny that it's not necessarily the big money moves that are kind of making waves. It's the backstories behind them. And this is where stuff kind of gets interesting, because Classy obviously bought as a replacement, or it appears to be a replacement for Schneiderlin. You've got the Sterling and Delph thing. Even though Sterling was big money, the backstory behind it was what kind of has kind of captured everyone's imagination, if you want to put it that way. I just find that kind of interest. I mean, you look at the Redfern thing, especially with the backstory behind that kind of taking center stage. So,
and let's not forget the backstory with Bastian Schweinsteiger,
of course, yeah,
joining Manchester United. Yeah. So there's everything with him and Pep Guardiola. There's everything with his injuries, everything with his age, everything with him and the hierarchy at Bayern Munich. And then, of course, there's the relationship with Louis van Gaal.
Well, everybody knows, wants to know. Yeah. What's going on? But, I mean, Russ Vernon...
Yeah, really interesting backstories. Yeah. And it looks like there was an earthquake because Yunus Kabul did join Sunderland.
Yeah,
and he must have not been registered very highly on the Richter scale at all.
Yeah, of course, must have been an earthquake coming from his back. Anyway, leaving that one aside. I mean, Russ Vernon, you wanted to jump in on some of these transfers that we've mentioned as well, didn't you?
I did, Liam. Yes. First and foremost, I'm going to jump in on the Benteke deal, and I think it's a good deal for Liverpool if Benteke should pass his medical, which he had earlier today, with a view to signing tomorrow or Wednesday, I heard earlier on today, Liam. And if he does sign, I think he'll probably play up front on his own until Sturridge is back, and then him and Sturridge will probably play 4-4-2 with him. Benteke and Sturridge up from where, and I'll probably play Ings just behind him, just off him, in the number 10 role Liverpool this season. I think the Delft of Man City was, I think he'll probably won't go straight into the side, but he'll have to fight for that place from Toure and Fernandinho, because they've got two brilliant holding midfielders where Delph plays, because I think they'll be playing that 4-2-3-1, which they played majority of last season. So I think he'll have to wait for a place there for that one. Going on to the Neil Redfern one, and I wasn't surprised when it happened. I've got a few quotes from some of the Leeds fans. One of the Leeds fans on Facebook, Paul Clark, said, "Red is the legend." Anthony Webster said, "What a legend. Word said from the art." And I don't think I agree with this one. "They should be ashamed." "Well, they won't be." Andy Pierce said, "What a sad loss for this once great club. Red is a legend." And I agree with this one from a Scunthorpe United fan, Jamie Morgan. His brother Carl is a Leeds fan. He's a Scunthorpe fan. He's put, "Chelino is a wrong one for you guys. He's going to destroy you." And I can see that now. And to be honest, I think what probably happened there was they waited until the likes of Louis Coyle, Lewis Cook, Charlie Taylor, Calvin Phillips, Lewis Walters, Chris Dawson, amongst all the youngsters that got offered professional contracts this summer, who was part of Redfern's academy, who fetched them through. I think they waited for all of them to agree the terms, sign on the dotted line, and then say, "The offer that we put in place for you, Redfern, Neil, wasn't genuine. I spoke to a couple of Leeds, former Leeds players when I went to the Parkgate v. Waltham game regarding this situation, Ady White, Paul Green and Fraser Richardson. And I found this a bit funny from what Paul Green said, and Richardson said it as well, when if they were Neil Redfern, they would have turned around and said to Chelina, even though you want me to go, you've put in my contract when I took over as head coach, that I can go back to my academy position if it didn't work out. You've got Uwe Rosling now, and whether you like it or not, I'm going back to the academy role, which you offered me, and where I'm happier, and where the players around so they can come and get some advice from me, who know me very well, and I think it'd be a very big loss for Leeds. It would be a good appointment for any club in the future. I think some of the times this season he'll probably come back and watch us play as a fan, because he's always been a Leeds fan, him and Lucy Ward, and then those will come and watch us. And because Lucy Ward was a part of the academy set up at Leeds, but she's now left along with Neil Redfern as well, Liam. She resigned on the 16th of July along with Neil Redfern. Mm-hmm. So those two will be a big loss to the academy. This has not been put out anywhere apart from one of the local papers by one of our reporters, Phil A. Steve Ed, one of the main academy products, one of the main one who academy overall manager with Redfern, like the other academy manager for like under 21s and under 18s. He was also sacked by Chelina last week, and he was one who brought them through, get them to Redfern, who helped progress their progress, like Byron Muller and Cook and Charlie Taylor and Phillips and Walters and Dawson, who's played for our first team. And I think he went into all those slots, signed up for next season and seasons beyond before saying Redfern you can go, and I think he's going to be a big miss. I just want to say thanks Redders, because if it wasn't for you last season along with Steve Thompson, you would have been in League One this upcoming season. So I want to say from everyone at Leeds United, the fans, this is Neil, thanks for keeping us up and making sure we play championship football and we're in a stable position going forward with Juve, Rosler and the team. Good luck for the season, Juve and his staff and the players.
You know, one interesting thing that was mentioned in that it just kind of gave me a bit of a throwback to bloody hell, I think it was something that Lance Storm might have said in the shoot interview about the breach tour, where it's like, yep, I'm not doing nothing if it breaches my contract. It's interesting that, well, if there was the provision in the contract that Redfern signed last year, until when he came back and managed Leeds, whether it be the first time or the second time, that said, oh yeah, if I leave this position or I get sacked, I can go back to the academy. In theory, he could sue the club. In theory, he probably wouldn't, but in theory, he could sue the club and say, well, you actually did breach my contract. So it's either you go and pay what you owe, or just slot me into that role, and we'll say nothing more about it. But this is the mess that Chelino has caused. And as I said, basically, and it was one of them, was a year and a half ago, week before Chelino even took over, we called it here on your Monday Night Football and Fix. We called it that Chelino would be no good for Leeds, and it's proving to be. Sadly, it is actually proving to be, and it's sad to see that it's happening. I mean, you got owners coming in, breezing in, changing everything, and in theory, looking like they're almost trying to strip mine the club. But it's not good to see this kind of situation. I mean, we got a special feature coming up in terms of not good situations, and also international continental talking points too. But it's just not good to see these kind of situations going on and being rampant in football as well. And as I said, in our next couple of segments, we'll be going onto situations that are not good either. It's just one of them ones. But, you know, but coming back to, as I said, I still think Neil Redfern should have seen this coming from what happened last season. One of them was down into Middlesbrough. Very good for Middlesbrough. Good for down into. Cabool got into Sunderland. Hey, the only thing for sure in football is nothing's for sure. You can also apply that to the Fabian Delph situation too. Classy. Hey, Dutch international. going to Southampton. Not a bad deal there. And he's worked with Ronald Koeman before too. Benteke to Liverpool. Most of me is happy with it. About 80%, 85% is happy with it. There's just that little bit of doubt for that bit, for that big money as well. But all right, every big money move has a bit of risk in it. So it is one of them ones. But hey, it is one of those where I don't know whether we'll see what happens with that. You know, Jesse Fizzle, I've got a question for you.
What's the question?
Are you ready?
I'm always ready.
Not to do the U-turn. Put your hands up and bend your knees, bounce around in a circle, get down with me. Come on. It's not hard to learn. Come on. It's called a U-turn. Well, Delph, Kabul, as well as Leeds United were involved in U-turns. But you know what? It is one of them ones. I did just allude to it a couple of minutes ago. But it is time for the next segment of the show, which just so happens to be
Pitch Talk's special feature.
Our Pitch Talk special feature this week is players, clubs, and professional contacts. That's where we're at. Beirut's Simon Yuklerod sent off for derogatory use of the word gay. This is from 9th of June 2015. Coming back to go forward. A Norwegian player was sent off for calling an opponent gay as referees in the country toughened their approach to homophobic language. Bayram SK's Simon Yuklerod was given a straight red for his abuse of a Sandnes Olive player in the second tier game. Head of referees Terry Haig. Said using the word in an insulting or offensive manner would lead to a sending off. Bayern were level at 2-2 when Yuklerod was dismissed, and the side went on to lose 3-2 in the first division game. Yuklerod looked stunned when referee Anders Jermsius brandished a red card as his side prepared to take a free kick. It is unclear who the abuse was aimed at, as the home side were in the process of forming a defensive wall. Bayern's players quickly surrounded the official in protest. There was a second I was not thinking and said the second word. Yes, said Yuklerod. Of course, it's completely lame, but I still think that it's not a red card. The midfielder denied attaching any form of expletive to the word, but his act will be investigated by Bayram. It's something that's been discussed several times after an incident a couple of years ago when a yellow card was given in a similar situation, said Hay, who was refereed at Champions League and World Cup level. We've told our referees that if they hear it clearly and there is no doubt about what's been said, then it should be punished with a red card. Hold on to that, because Fulham midfielder fined £20,000 by club and £5,000 by the FA and misses first two games for Chelsea player tweet. This from the 17th of June 2015. Ryan Tunnicliffe will count the cost of one poorly thought out tweet in terms of a £25,000 fine and missed games. The Fulham midfielder will also miss the first two fixtures of the new campaign after posting the tweet about Chelsea forward Patrick Bamford, who was on loan at Middlesbrough last season. The 22-year-old was convicted of aggravated misconduct by reference to sexual orientation after comments posted on his Twitter account in the aftermath of Middlesbrough's defeat to Norwich City in the playoff final at Wembley. The former Man United Academy graduate tweeted, "Happy that Middlesbrough didn't go up, just for the main fact that @Patrick_Bamford is a sausage boy." The tweet was then deleted from Tunnicliffe's account. The player admitted the charge and faced a two-game suspension at the beginning of next season, as well as being hit with the £25,000 combined fine. The midfielder has also been ordered to attend a mandatory education course as well. Now, moving on even further, a Fulham club statement made plain their anger with Tunnicliffe. It said the club, which has a zero tolerance policy for antisocial behaviour of any kind, can also confirm that it will be taking action against Ryan for his unacceptable actions. Now, moving now, staying with the 17th of June 2015, and also with young players as well. Leicester City sacked three players, including manager Nigel Pearson's son, after they took part in a racist sex tape filmed on the club's end-of-season tour of Thailand. James Pearson, 22 years old, Tom Hopper, 21 years old, and Adam Smith, 22 years old, had their contracts terminated following an internal investigation by the club. The three development squad players had apologised for their behaviour. Now, there's more to this because it shows that football's an unscrupulous sport. Northampton Town signed, we're talking 9 days later, Northampton Town signed sacked Leicester City keeper. Northampton Town agreed a two-year deal with goalkeeper Adam Smith, who was recently sacked by Leicester City for his part in a racist sex video. It was one of them, as everyone knows, I caught myself in a situation which I'm deeply ashamed of and sorry for, said Smith. Tom Hopper, another one of the players, Scunthorpe signed sacked Leicester City striker on the same day as it happened. Scunthorpe United signed striker Tom Hopper, who was recently sacked by Leicester City for his part in the racist sex video as well. It's one of them ones. In terms of second chances, it's kind of a precedent because while in charge of Oxford, Northampton boss Chris Wilder signed both Luke McCormick, sacked by Plymouth in 2008 after causing the death of two children in a car crash, and Adam Chapman, convicted of causing death by dangerous driving following their release from prison. Now, little more to that Leicester situation. Leicester City sacked Nigel Pearson on the 30th of June 2015. Leicester City sacked manager Nigel Pearson, saying the working relationship between him and the club's board was no longer viable. Now, Pearson was involved in several high-profile incidents, including calling a journalist an ostrich and clashing with Crystal Palace's James McArthur. It has become clear that fundamental differences in perspective exist between us, said a club statement. Of course, the Leicester statement actually thanked Pearson for his considerable contribution and added, the board of directors recognises the success Nigel has helped to bring to Leicester City during his two spells in charge, particularly during the last 3.5 years. Now, of course, we mentioned about his son James being involved in a racist sex tape while on tour in Thailand, home of the club's billionaire owners. On the 1st of July, Nigel Pearson's sacking by Leicester was linked to his son's role in a racist sex tape in the owner's homeland of Thailand, the BBC learned. Pearson's son, James, was one of the three trainees dismissed by the club for their involvement. The issue was the final straw in the deteriorating relationship between the owners and Pearson. Apparently it was actually put out and reported at the time that the 51-year-old sacking was definitely not a football issue. It was said that the Pioneer owners acted because they were concerned about the damage to the club's reputation, while a Leicester statement said the relationship between Pearson and the board was no longer viable. So it is one of them ones. It's difficult to convince people this is for footballing reasons. He's never been as strong, has he? That was from Steve Claridge telling BBC Radio 5 Live that two or three occasions last season, the owners would have been more than justified. We then lauded the fact that they stuck by their manager. The statement doesn't refer to the fact that he was sacked for footballing reasons. Now, shifting on, a dangerous precedent potentially set because Malky Mackay and Ian Moody faced no FA action over text. This is from July 16th, 2015. Former Cardiff City boss Malky Mackay and head of recruitment Ian Moody will face no action over allegations they shared racist and sexist text. The Football Association said it had carried out a thorough investigation into the language used in the messages. It found the communications were sent with a legitimate expectation of privacy. Keep that one in mind. The FA added in a statement today, the FA's policy in cases such as this has been to not bring charges in respect of private communications sent with a legitimate expectation of privacy. In the 11-month investigation, another thing to keep in mind, 27 witnesses were spoken to by the FA, which said the process was delayed by serious concerns over the circumstances in which particular evidence provided to the FA had been given. The nature of these concerns, which the FA treats with the utmost seriousness, has necessitated significant further inquiries by the FA and the liaison with external law enforcement agencies. Now, basically the background to that we went over when it originally happened. It was a case of Malky Mackay was sacked as Cardiff Bluebirds manager in December 2013 when they were just outside the relegation zone. And the following August, Cardiff alleged Mackay sent racist, sexist and homophobic text messages during his time there as manager. Similar claims were made against Ian Moody, who had been dismissed by the club for an alleged 15 million transfer overspend, which he denied. Now, Moody left his post as Crystal Palace sporting director shortly after the allegations were made. Mackay admitted sending the offensive messages and apologised, adding that he was not racist, sexist, homophobic or anti-Semitic. He was then appointed Wigan Athletic manager, which caused a bit of controversy, despite the club being urged to reconsider by campaigners who cited the FA investigation into the text messages. He then got sacked after a string of poor results, but it is a case of the investigation was ongoing at that point, which we were critical of at the time as well. But Kick It Out said the FA's promise to review its policy was lamentably late in the day. The FA has damaged its own credibility and anti-discrimination policies by taking the decision not to charge Malky Mackay and Ian Moody. The FA needed to take a strong position to help prove football's zero tolerance approach towards discriminatory practices. Instead, we have another example of the status quo being reinforced and discriminatory practices being allowed to flourish in no-go areas, such as within the exclusivity of boardrooms, training grounds, dressing rooms, and via private communication networks. How can anybody truly challenge discrimination and prejudice attitudes in football with confidence now? The apparent reluctance to punish comments and behaviour considered as banter or light-hearted culture within these settings is entirely damaging. Now, it's one of them. The FA's ruling did come after somewhat of a precedent, because Blackpool chairman Carl Oyston was given a 6-week ban from all football activity and fined £40,000 for a text message exchange with a fan. Oyston, though, admitted a misconduct charge after referring to a supporter as a retard. Apologies if that offended anyone. It was a direct quote. The FA said it was determined to eliminate discriminatory conduct in all its forms and will now look to introduce a policy governing behaviour in private. It added the FA is in the process of carrying out a complex review involving all stakeholders on how communications, and in particular those involving discriminatory language, which may be viewed as taking place in private, should be treated in the future. Now, it is a case of the FA's failure to charge Malky Mackay and Ian Moody over allegations they sent discriminatory texts sends a shocking message, says former footballer Jason Roberts. It's from the 17th of July 2015. The FA said it could not punish the ex-Cardiff Cardiff manager and head of recruitment because the text was sent with a legitimate expectation of privacy. But the decision sets a dangerous precedent, said ex-striker Jason Roberts. With real issues of governance, where the FA have to take a real stand, we see a lack of will and determination. Sends a shocking message to football and more worryingly to wider society. The FA said it had spoken to Mackay and Moody about the inappropriateness of terms used in the messages following an 11-month investigation that involved 27 witnesses. Now, it is a case of There's a bit more to go into on this, because Russian club UFA won't back Frimpong. This is from the 18th of July 2015. Russian club UFA have shockingly revealed that they won't be backing their Ghanaian midfielder Emmanuel Frimpong by calling for rival Spartak Moscow to be punished, even though he was racially abused by fans of the Giants. UFA General Director Shamil Gazizov says his club would not be calling for Spartak to be punished, describing it as an unfortunate incident, insisting they are friends of the Moscow club. After Jesus face palm on that one. Former Arsenal player Emmanuel Frimpong was sent off playing for Russian side FC UFA after he gestured to the crowd with his middle finger in response to alleged monkey chants. And if you've seen the video, those monkey chants are pretty damn clear. When the match was stopped, the fans started shouting monkey at me, said Garner's Frimpong after the 2-2 draw. Shocking his club... It is shocking that his club UFA won't be standing up for him, who is at the end of the abuse. There were people who could have shouted things. These are emotions which go away after the game. We are partners with the red and whites and are on good terms, Gazizov said. What Frimpong did was wrong. Sometimes you even have to hold back the tears and just put up with it. Russia hosts the next World Cup in 2018. and Frimpong had it abused, and yet we're going to hold a World Cup in this country where Africans will have to come to play football. Now, Swan Lemos, Man City and Ivory Coast midfielder Yaya Toure has previously been abused while playing in Russia as well in the Champions League, which we've mentioned before. And also last season, Torpedo Moscow's Congolese defender Christopher Samba was banned for 2 matches for gesturing to fans following racist abuse. Again, we've gone over those two specifically in Rants of the Weeks and Pitch Talks. And sorry, and Push Points on youtube.com/pitch talk. You can actually find those. I think it's Samba and the Russian Torpedo of Racism, and I cannot remember the one off the top of my head regarding Yaya Toure, but I think it is a ROTW or a Push Point on YouTube. Now, quite a lot to take in there. Jazzy Fizzle, do you want to kick off before I have my opinion on this? And the Skypers, if you want to jump in, have at it too.
Well, let's start with the Frimpong abuse. I think it's unbelievable that the club aren't going to stand by their player. And it kind of goes back to what I was saying before. Clubs aren't loyal.
And it's sad.
Not in Russia anyway. And as we said, this is where we're going to go and have a World Cup.
Yeah.
Right? And they're supposed to be the big Say No to Racism campaign. I don't really know how any of that is really working out, especially in this particular situation. The other question that I asked to Emmanuel Frimpong is, knowing that you're going to face that, and I'm not advising that he, you know, picks up and leaves either. I'm not advising that, because I think sometimes there are times in your life where you have to take a stand and actually not pick up and leave. You have to stay and deal with the situation that's there. Sometimes.
Yeah.
Right. So my question to him is, knowing that this is what you're going to go through, are you willing to stay? Or will you look to move? Now, whatever he decides, I'm not going to hold it against him, because look, it's difficult. It's not a straightforward decision with this. Right? And at the same time, it's like, so the Russian FA aren't going to do anything? Are UEFA going to do anything? Are FIFA going to do anything? That's my question.
Yeah. But see, the burden is on the powers that be to do something.
This is it. Right? And as I say, the club comes out and says, oh, it's an unfortunate incident, but they're friends of the bigger club. Like, okay, I understand that you may be friends, but here's the thing. Your friend has just insulted you, right? And the conversation's got really real.
Mm.
Here's the thing. If you're friends don't deal with friends like that.
Yeah.
Or at least that's not how I deal with my friends. Isn't it? Yeah? Really, you're talking about frenemies now.
Mm.
And frenemies we deal very differently with. So that whole thing, as I said, whatever Emmanuel Frimpong decides to do, I personally support him. I'm not a member of the Dench gang. I wasn't really a fan of him as a youngster at Arsenal per se. But in this particular situation, I feel he needs as much support as he can get. So from me, Jazzy Fizzle, to you, Emmanuel Frimpong, I got you, man.
Bro, I'm on the same tip
on
as well.
The real, I've got you. Black Star, yeah. Keep shining. Because right about now, this is the issue that, well, really needs to be looked at. And as I said, if this is a country where we're hosting a World Cup, here's the thing. I understand that every club, every country, every continent has their own moronic minority, to quote the straight shooting one. I'm well aware of that. And here's the other thing. Now it's up to the rest of Russia to show. It's like, look, they're not representative of all of us. And I really do think it's about time for FIFA to really go and look into, you know, with an incident like this, is it with the, you know, let's say No to Racism campaign, can they afford to have a World Cup in this country with incidents like that? That's the real question.
Of course. But then,
unless, of course, you want all multicultural nations to withdraw.
But right? then, but then, one thing I would ask you to do is then bring it back home with some of the other stuff that we're in.
Yeah, that too. I mean, if we go back to the beginning now, because I really wanted to talk about that. Here's the thing, right? Homophobia in general, yeah, we need to let that go. As a society, we need to let that go. Right? Here's the thing. I respect my decision to go on the Jazzy Fizzle Sizzle tour in 2016. And I respect anybody else's decision to do what they want to do. The bottom line, that's your life. As long as you're happy and you're enjoying it, more power to you. There may be some things that personally we may not agree on, but if we can agree to disagree, then fine. As I say, you know, it's your life, more power to you. More love, more life. That's all I have to say about it overall, right? But for me, as I say, bringing that ignorance, because that's what it is, ignorance to football and on a football pitch, there's no need for it. And I think that the players do need to be punished, and punished harshly, uniformly, and in a draconian fashion, right? Because here's the bit. Whether they like it or not, and I know we say this time and time again, that football and footballers are not role models. It's not how you're supposed to live this life in terms of the guideline. I'm aware of that. But there is also the responsibility of these people that are in such high-profile positions to do something where they're showing people the right way, especially youngsters, impressionable youngsters. It's not going to be tolerated anymore. It's not going to be tolerated either. You understand and respect the society that you're in, where all of these fans, irrespective of their sexual orientation, gender, etc., are supporting your club. That means you had to support them. It's as simple as that. Yeah. It's really not overly complicated. And if the clubs aren't doing anything to go and you know, really enforce that, if the FAs aren't doing enough to enforce that, if UEFA aren't doing enough to enforce that, if FIFA are not doing enough to enforce that, I ask one simple question. What is the point?
I mean,
the point? What is the aim if the powers that be are not, you know, really taking a stand and showing that, you know, this isn't going to be tolerated? Right? Last time I checked, football for me was all about inclusion. Right? Doesn't matter if at primary school you were the one that were picked last. You were still picked.
Yeah. Well, was everyone
still picked. You were part of it. And you know what? It was through regular playing that you ended up getting better at the game anyway. Right? It was one of those things, irrespective of everything else. You might have liked different music. You might have liked different clothes. You might have liked different TV. Might have even had different friends. But when it came to football, that was when you... And, well, I suppose, for lack of a better term, the cool kids, you all got on. Maybe off the pitch, not so much, but during the game, yeah. Yeah. So I'm like, if football has the power to go and unite communities where we now have blood drives and organ donations, saving people's lives over in Brazil, and talking specifically about Sport Recife and their eternal fans policy.
Brilliant, yeah.
Right? What is this? What is this if football has the power to do that? I mean, seriously.
Yeah. I mean, what do you reckon of the Makai Moody thing as well, then?
The Makai Moody thing with the lack of punishment there, for me personally, ridiculous. Right? You know what this is? This is the powers that be in the FA missing a trick. Absolutely, is them missing a trick. They say, well, oh, well, there was intended to be privacy. I'm pretty sure, right? with the tweets, you could go and argue, well, I didn't think that the FA was going to look at it. So that was intended to have privacy.
Yeah.
You could argue that, you know, intended privacy for a lot of different things. It doesn't wash. As I said, these people, whether they like it or not, they are role models. There are certain rules and guidelines that they have to adhere to. Therefore, right, whether it's their personal beliefs or somebody else's, no, those are not to be expressed. It's as simple as that. Right? And maybe, you know, I'm sounding a bit authoritarian and not, you know, allowing free speech, so on and so forth. But here's the other bit. If you choose to be in this game and in the media spotlight of this game, those are part of the sacrifices that you have to make. Yeah. It really is that simple. And it's not really a sacrifice when really what we're talking about is another human being, another child of God. That's what we're talking about. Right? In the sense of, if you have any respect for yourself, how are you going to go and say that to another human being? Really, is I really look at it on that really basic level.
Yeah, no, you have.
And I'm probably being over dramatic, right, about it and getting really emotional about it and, you know, really projecting my passion on it. But it's a matter of, as I say, if football is supposed to be as great as it can be, then, as I say, the powers that be need to do things where it says, look, it's not going to be tolerated anywhere you do it. If you're involved in football, no, because that's not what football is about, not here. No, simple as.
Yeah.
All right, well, it's all this, oh, well, we can't. So, look, you might as well say you can't punish anybody full stop for anything. Right? There has to be a line in the sand somewhere.
Yeah.
Right? It's a matter of you have to stand for something or you fall for anything.
I like that. Yeah, let's see. That is a good point. That is a good point. I mean, coming briefly back to the Frimpong, issue. I mean, Tom Wood, you wanted to jump in. You wanted to jump in, didn't you?
Yeah, if I was Frimpong, I would say to the club, let me go, or I won't play for the club ever again, or not even train.
But then, in theory, isn't that letting the cretins win?
Not really. He's probably had it. I think if he wants to move out of the country, then let him just move to a different club where he's going to probably be liked and not going to get abused.
Yeah.
I'd be
surprised if he come back to England, but I don't think he would.
Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like what I was saying, and I said, look, if he wanted to leave, then, you know, I understand that. If he wants to go on strike, I understand that. If he wants to stay, I understand that. But again, for me, that's his decision. He has to figure that out. And it's not necessarily about does this person win, does that person win, so on and so forth. It's more about how things are set up. In the sense of, does he have the required protection over there? Honestly, I don't believe so. Not if his club are coming out and saying, it's an unfortunate incident.
Yeah,
we're friends of the other club.
Yeah.
Not to say, right, even though we used to have a wonderful working relationship with this club, they've actually abused one of our players and it will not be tolerated. To say there's two very different messages there. So you can pick whichever one you want.
Yeah. But you know what? You know, I want to jump in on this because, I mean,
yeah, please.
I mean, Seaman Euclerod getting sent off for using the word gay. Fantastic. Good. It's one of them ones. The fact of the matter is, why do you need to use that word for? Why do you need to use that word on the football pitch? Why do you need to use it in a derogatory way to someone on a football pitch? Why do you need to use it on the football pitch generally? Good. You got sent off? Good. Couldn't agree more. More referee. I think every referee, if they hear people chucking out homophobic slurs or racial slurs, boom, send them off straight away. Send them off straight away, ban them. Punish uniformly and in a draconian fashion. It's one of them was. Euclerod might say, oh, there was a second where I was not thinking, but that second just cost you and cost your team. So the fact that you got punished harshly for it, the fact that you got sent straight off for it by the referee, maybe you'll learn your lesson. Maybe you'll learn words like that will not be tolerated on the football pitch. Maybe. It's one of them ones. Hopefully. The fact of the matter is, he's still saying, oh yeah, I still think it's not a red card. But then you're saying two different things. Well, it's one of them ones. You're saying what you said was completely lame, but then you're trying to bring up that there's a discrepancy and you don't agree with the red card. Bro, you're sending more mixed messages than FIFA do. Fact of the matter is, Seaman, you Clarod, hey, it's one of them ones. Life sucks and then you die. You throw out homophobic slurs, you're getting sent off for it. And I totally agree with the referee. I would totally back the referee in that situation if I was one of the powers that be. And I would hand down an edict saying to referees, if you hear any homophobic slurs used, any racial slurs used, red card them straight away, and we will punish them as well on top. And we will back you as a referee in that. That for me is part of a solution. Re-education is also part of a solution as well. With the Ryan Tunnicliffe thing, him being handed a £25,000 fine, good. I'm in agreement with that, and also banned for a couple of games too. Good. I'm in agreement with that. And Fulham coming out saying, hey, we're going to take action and this is unacceptable. That's the attitude you need to have. That is the attitude you need to have, and you need to do something as well. And also attend it, being ordered to attend the mandatory education course. Good. That is the powers that be actually doing something right. The Leicester City situation with three players getting sacked over racist sex tape. Good. I'm glad those owners had the balls to do it. One question would be though, is that if they were first team players, like let's just pluck three names out of the air. Let's just pluck out Kasper Schmeichel, Leonardo Ulloa, and Esteban Cambiaso, for instance. If it had been, or actually, you know what? I'm going to chuck in Wes Morgan. Just pluck him three names out. It'd be one of them ones. If it was Ulloa, Morgan, and Kasper Schmeichel, hopefully that outcome would have been the same. Hopefully. But that's one of the concerns where clubs sometimes send mixed messages. But the fact that Northampton Town signed Adam Smith 9 days after he had been sacked, and Scunthorpe signed Tom Hopper, it shows you that football is an unscrupulous sport. I'm not saying people shouldn't be given second chances, but we're talking 9 days. That ain't even enough time to attend a mandatory education course. 9 days. That is how unscrupulous a sport football is. It's one of them ones. But Nigel Pearson being sacked and his relationship with the club becoming untenable, I can understand that. Because basically for me, as soon as I saw the news of his son being sacked, I was thinking to myself, okay, this makes Nigel Pearson's relationship very interesting considering they've just sacked his son. And the reason for it as well. So you can't say that the Nigel Pearson thing was a surprise. It's one of them was, I can understand Nigel Pearson standing by his son potentially if that was the reason. But the fact of the matter is, I can understand the relationship becoming somewhat fractured because of that. I can totally understand that. And you know what? It was one of them ones where maybe it's best for all parties to part ways. Because if Pearson's angry about that stuff happening to his son, and he's articulating that to the owners, then it's like, you know what? If you want to leave, then the opportunity is there for you. I can understand that. But it is one of them was Malky Mackay and Ian Moody facing no action over the text. I'm with Jason Roberts. It does set a dangerous precedent. But legally, if you're sending those texts in private, first of all, how did they end up leaking out? And secondly, who got them as well? Because that brings up legal ramifications and legal issues as well, wherein if something was sent privately, like the Richard Scudamore thing, which I think Scudamore potentially should have lost his job over that. But what's it? Should Scudamore plus sexism equal the sack? I think was it was either a pitch talk push point or a rant of the week that we've got on youtube.com/pitch talk. So I personally think Richard Scudamore should have lost his job over that. Moody and Mackay should also have been punished. They should have been punished very harshly, because at the end of the day, all right, even though it was said in public, it was still said. That's the bottom line. It was still said. So to a certain extent, if you're saying that, and you're trying to dismiss it as banter in inverted commas, it still means that somewhere inside you, those beliefs potentially reside. So there needs to be a fine just to show, right, you can't get away with this, especially when you're in a position of power as well. You can't get away with this crap. Just like, it's one of them ones. Just like I said, the Richard Scudamore deal, where he was sending sexist emails. They were supposed to be private internal emails, but the fact of the matter is you sent them and they were inappropriate. Moody and Mackay were sending inappropriate text messages and they said a lot of inflammatory stuff. So it's one of them was in that position of power. You can't be saying that kind of crap. You can't be doing that. Now, moving on to the Frimpong thing with this Russian club not backing him. That Russian club, FC UFA. You know what? I'm going to use Didier Drogba to help me describe you as a club.
Hey, it's a disgrace. It's a disgrace.
The fact of the matter is it is an absolute disgrace. And it is that the club won't back him after seeing him get racially abused. This is not him just throwing up a middle finger and letting it linger just for the sake of it. The dude's been racially abused. If I was racially abused on the football pitch, as cool and calm and collected as I usually am on a regular basis, I'm a little more highly strung on the football pitch, but I'm going to react to it. I mean, it's one of them. See, this is another case, just like UEFA back in 2012 with the Euros. It's like, you know what? If you react to it and you walk off the pitch, we'll punish you. It's like, no, you stupid. You're going to punish the victims instead of punishing the people actually doing it. Are you stupid? Like a broken needle, kid, you missing the point. To quote John Cena's basic Fugonomics tune. For me, this Russian club,
Frimpong was wrong. He should just accept it and like take it, hold back the tears and just take it.
To that Russian club, FC UFA, and say, oh yeah, but we're friends with that club. You know what?
If I want any crap out of you, I'll pick it out of your teeth.
That's the way I feel about that. It's an absolute disgrace that your own club that you play for, that you put in your efforts for. All right, yeah, they're paying you because it's a job at the end of the day. But the fact of the matter is, if I didn't have the support of my club in that situation, I am walking. And I'm walking so quickly, I'm not even letting the door have a chance to hit me on the backside on the way out. It's a circus. This kind of thing is an absolute disgrace, and it's a circus because the powers that be need to be stepping in on this. If this Russian club is not going to take any action, and their chairman and their general director Shamil Gazizov said his club ain't going to be calling for Spartak to be punished, there's no point asking for the Russian FA to step in. There's no point. This needs to go straight to UEFA, and UEFA need to do something about it instead of trying to play power politics, which we're going to go on to in the next segment. Instead of trying to play power politics with FIFA, this is the kind of thing that Michel Platini needs to be standing up against. If you're serious about the respect campaign, if you're serious about stamping homophobia, about stamping racism out of football, then these incidents right here, FIFA, as well, this is where you need to be stepping in, where the powers that be, such as our own FA, where the powers that be, such as the Russian FA, are not stepping in. You need to start exerting some of your power and using it for good. Instead of having Platini playing power games and getting people to get behind him in terms of trying to take over the FIFA presidency, I said more on that later. You need to be trying to stamp these plagues of the game out of the game. It's one of them. That's what needs to happen. Like Jesse Fizzle said, Manuel Frimpong, hey, I would be one of them ones where I'd be like, you know what? If you're not gonna back me, I'm gonna leave. And if you want to sue me for breaching a contract, feel free to sue me. But I have my reasons for leaving. Some say love it or leave it. Well, in terms of Russia, in a footballing sense, I think I'd leave it. I'm not painting every single Russian person with that brush. Far from it. We've had instances where CSKA Moscow have been involved in racist abuse of Yaya Toure. You had the Zenit St. Petersburg fans what's it, Zenit fans and the racist elite team dream is one of our, I think it's a rant of the week. It's one of them ones. That's two. Christopher Samba and the Russian torpedo of racism with Torpedo Moscow. That's three big instances. And this one makes four. So three strikes and you're out is already out the window. This is four. This is four big ones. And the fact of the matter is, I said, you got the powers that be sending mixed messages. It's an absolute disgrace. It really is. If I want to crap out of these people, I would pick it out of their damn teeth, because that's all they're talking is crap and nothing. I mean, the FA with this Mackay case, it's one of them was, even though there is supposed to be, oh, legitimate expectation of privacy. Well, this text got leaked out. These texts got leaked out. So the privacy goes out the window. In theory, it doesn't matter how you got the text. The fact is, you've got them, you know what's been said, and you know who it's been said by, and you know the context in which they've been said as well. So you need to step up to the plate, FA, and punish. I'm with Kick It Out and Jason Roberts. It has damaged reputations because the FA once again look like they're a day late and a dollar short. And the fact, and for me, one of the major factors is, once again, football has an opportunity to be a standard bearer against racism, against homophobia. But paltry punishments mean that they're not stepping up to the plate. And instead of being used to unite and to encourage people to get these blights upon the game that we love out, once again, they've sent mixed messages and they've dropped the ball. They've dropped the ball. It is one of them ones. I mean, you're going to punish. I find it funny that the FA don't punish Mackay and Moody for their comments, even though there was racist, homophobic and anti-Semitic comments in there. They don't punish those two for that. But they punish Ryan Tunnicliffe. They punish Ryan Tunnicliffe quite harsh. Well, actually, quite fairly. They punish Ryan Tunnicliffe for his homophobic comments. You got him getting punished for one of the three, but Mackay and Moody not getting punished for three separate types of offensive comments. Don't get it. Really don't get it. It is one of them ones. But you know what? As I said, it is one of them ones, man. It is absolutely disgraceful. It really is. It really, really is.
And I have to agree with you. I think when you even look at it in that comparative analytic way where you say, yeah, actually, Ryan Tunnicliffe, he's guilty of a serious offence, but only one, right? And these guys are guilty of multiple offences.
And they're in positions of power as well.
And they don't get punished. It really doesn't add up. And this is everything. It's inconsistent, right? I'm like, the reason why the FA aren't being taken seriously, along with the fact that they don't go and deal with these issues, to be fair, they kind of shirk them and hope for the best, in my personal opinion, is that there's no consistency there. Right? So, as you pointed out, Ryan Tunnicliffe, he gets punished. Rightly so. I'm not saying he doesn't deserve to be punished. I'm saying, yes, he deserves it. Yes, they're right. But in terms of Malky Mackay, right? What's happening there?
Bridget, you got to punish him uniformly.
I'm asking this is the question
this is
of,
this is the mixed
where's
message.
The difference, right, between what happened with Malky Mackay and Ian Moody and what Ryan Tunnicliffe did? As far as I'm concerned, it's the same thing. And you've had this 11-month investigation, 27 witnesses, yeah. And all you can decide at the end of that is, well, there's not really much we can do. So what was the point?
Exactly. It's BS. It's BS all the way
so
around.
So essentially, all the money that you spent on this 11-month investigation talking to these 27 witnesses, it was a waste of time. Essentially.
I mean,
and as you said, okay, there might have been a legitimate expectation of privacy, but look, there was no privacy because it got out.
Yeah.
So that expectation of privacy, once it gets out, sorry, it's not there anymore.
But the
right?
fact,
it's
but
the
fact
thing
that they're saying that stuff anyway doesn't, it's one of them, was this even worse that they're saying that stuff anyway?
No, but this is my point. It's the same thing with the celebrities getting upset, right, when they have, you know, interesting, shall we say, photos of themselves and videos on public websites where it's known that hackers, you know, like to go there and do their business, right? And they get upset when these photos and videos are exposed. It's like, well, look, there's a real simple way to protect yourself in this.
Don't do it in the first place.
This is my thing. Right? Just don't do it. Literally, just don't do it. Right? The other thing is, don't put it there. Right? Of all the places for you to put it, don't put it there.
It's just one of them ones. I mean, it's just, I mean, this
if, you know, and I'm not advocating any of those things, but the point I'm making is, I'm like, come on, is it really, like, yeah, there was that expectation, but once it got out, therefore you have to look at everybody else around you and say, well, somebody's released this, right? It's not private anymore, therefore it's public domain, therefore, right, just from the basic deductions, right, I'm not even looking at it from a legal perspective, I'm not trying to be Hercules Poirot, but once it's out, it's out. And if it's out, then you can punish them. The only thing I'm thinking of is that the FA, honestly, they're like a bulldog with no teeth. So they make a lot of noise, and the worst thing that they'll do to you is gum you a little bit. That's about it.
I mean, it's one of them. I mean, it's one of them ones. This the whole thing is just utterly. It just baffles me. It just baffles me. But you know what? Yeah. I think we might have to stay at that emotional level because a big welcome to Jaymie Bailey, who's joined us, and also Kieran Riley have joined us in the Scrap Chat as well.
I think
it's one of them ones we might have to take a quick break just to kind of cool the jets. But as I said, we've still got a lot more show to go through. But it is one of them ones where, as I said, this whole thing with the powers that be dropping the ball again. Once again, a chance has gone awry in terms of setting an example. But speaking of setting an example, we're going to be back in a minute because there's a lot more to be said about setting examples. You know what? We will be right back after these short messages.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pitch Talk proudly presents a full sit-down interview with a level 5 referee operating in Southern Amateur League and more. For 2 years, he was club secretary for a football club in Burnt Oak. In April 2015, he was elected AFA Youth Council Chairman. His aims include having input on development and more.
To ask Darrell a question during our special interview, email pitchtalk@gmail.com and put Darrell David in the subject line. Pitch Talk meets Darrell David, coming soon.
The football talk show that holds back nothing on opinions.
Straight shooting LJA.
Hi, I'm John Sitton.
Grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
The G-Man.
Samir Sawney, Motivate Sports and Fitness.
Christian Carambeau.
Matt Hodgson, director of the 4-year plan.
We the people, for the people. Jazzy Fizzle.
Your Monday night football fix.
Make sure you join the revolution.
The pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk. Eating every Monday night of your lives
at youtube.com/pitchtalk.
For podcast links and information, check out our official website www.pitch-talk.com.
Your Monday night footballing fix, Pitch Talk, is brought to you by and in association with
Talking Pie, a local podcast made by the fans for the fans of Notts County FC, hosted by Adam and Thomas Hewitt.
Simply Exclusive Entertainment. If you need a party or rave film, go to sxemedia.com for more information.
Apparently Rich. Simple yet effective web solutions to help get your company off the ground. Visit apparentlyrich.com for more information. And LJA Productions, the new blood in digital video. If you need a video filmed and or edited, check out ljaproductions.co.uk. LJA Productions, the new blood in digital video, offering video production services such as video editing, video encoding for the web, including YouTube and Vimeo, audio recording, filming of interviews, promos, live events, and much more. Get in touch at www.ljaproductions.co.uk or twitter.com/LJA Productions and let the new blood in digital video promote you. Pitch Talk is brought to you by and in association with
the one-stop shop for all your coaching needs, Motivate Sports and Fitness. Check out motivatesportsandfitness.com for more information.
The new football culture magazine, Thin White Line. Check out thinwhitelinemagazine.com for more information.
Storm FM with new hot releases played daily. Feel the boom at stormfm.net.
Two girls with their Bonnie Scotty trying to cover as much women's football as they can. Girls on the Ball. Check out girlsontheball.com for more information.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
Grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Christian Carambeur.
Matt Hodgson, director of the four-year plan.
Dave Bogotkin.
I'm Rob Lusher.
Andy Copeland from the Glenmet Southern Amateur League.
Philip Wick, I'm CEO of 14.
Former chairman of Ibis FC.
Chairman of Alexandra Park FC.
And you're listening.
And you're listening to Pitch Talk.
The only place to get your Monday night footballing fix.
Because the pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk. Make sure you join the revolution, the football revolution.
In honor of Jaymie Bailey, who's joined us.
And it's time for that turn of pace as we move into international and continental talking points.
You're dying right. It is one of them ones. And there's been quite a lot of developments in the past 24 hours, actually. But we're going to go back a bit to come forward. Now, FIFA crisis. World Cup bidders to be banned from foreign investment from July 16, 2015. FIFA plans to amend World Cup bidding rules by banning countries from investing in overseas football development projects. Football's world governing body will also demand bidding nations adhere to United Nations standards on human rights and labor laws. Swiss prosecutors are investigating the Russia 2018 and Qatar 2022 awards, with both denying any wrongdoing. The bidding process for the 2026 World Cup has also been postponed. The existing clause, which mandated all countries wishing to stage the World Cup to pump money into the game outside their own borders, will be scrapped. Doesn't make sense anyway. Bidding nations will not be allowed to spend money overseas both prior to and after any vote. FIFA sources have acknowledged that the regulation increased the risk of corruption. In terms of 2026, the front runners are the USA look to be the front runners to stage tournament, but Canada, Mexico, and Colombia are also thought to be interested. And the vote to decide who will host the 2026 World Cup is due to take place in Kuala Lumpur in May 2017. From the 19th of July 2015, Jeffrey Webb pleads not guilty in the US. Former FIFA Vice President Jeffrey Webb has pleaded not guilty in connection with a massive corruption scandal in the World Football Governing Body. He was placed under house arrest on $10 million, £6.4 million bail by a New York judge. Mr. Webb, who's from the Cayman Islands, is accused of accepting bribes worth millions of dollars in connection with the sale of marketing rights. He was detained in Switzerland in May along with six football officials and was this week extradited to the US. He was not the only one to contest his extradition from Switzerland and the first to appear in an American court. Yeah, he was the only one not to contest it. He must remain at home within a 20-mile radius of the court. His movements will be monitored via an electronic tag, and he has already relinquished three of his passports, two of which are UK passports. His lawyer declined to comment. Now, the key allegations in regards to Jeffrey Webb of the Cayman Islands are wire fraud conspiracy and wire fraud, money laundering conspiracy and money laundering, obstruction of justice, and if convicted, the defendant could face 20 years in prison. That is mad. But it is one of them was FIFA president Sepp Blatter to reveal reform plans. This was from the 20th of July. FIFA president Sepp Blatter was set to announce his plans on to reform FIFA football's crisis hit governing body today, Monday, 20th of July, 2015. There had been a bit of a build-up over the past few weeks that saying that, yep, this is going to be the first time Blatter will face the media since the resignation announcement. But moving on from that, Blatter will also hold talks with FIFA's executive committee over a date for the new presidential election. The 79-year-old announced on June 2nd he was stepping aside as head of FIFA, having just been re-elected. We've gone over that in detail. But it is one of them was also from today, Monday, 20th of July, 2015. UEFA boss asked to stand for FIFA presidency, Michel Platini. I alluded to this at the end of the last segment, but UEFA boss Michel Platini has been asked by a majority of world football chiefs to stand for the FIFA presidency. Platini is said to have had assurances of support from his own confederation, Asia, South America, plus North and Central America and the Caribbean. It's for 60-year-old Platini has yet to decide whether he will stand. FIFA president Sepp Blatter said on June 2nd he would stand down and today announced plans for reforms of FIFA. Now, those reforms were announced earlier. New task force announced to tackle corruption. And there's a reason there sounds like there's a bit of apathy in my voice. FIFA is to set up a task force of 11 people looking at reforming football scandal hit world governing body. Proposals for reform will include term limits for presidents and integrity checks for top officials, President Sepp Blatter announced. There's an irony in that already. FIFA will hold an extraordinary congress to elect its new president on February 26, 2016, he added as well. Blatter, who's 79, announced he would stand down in June, just 4 days after being re-elected. Blatter's resignation followed the arrest of seven FIFA officials as part of a United States investigation that saw 14 people in total indicted on corruption charges. We spent three Pitch Talk episodes in terms of special features in National Continental Talking Points going over those. Those are on youtube.com/pitch talk. I think as Pitch Talk Push Points. So check that out if you want all the background on that. So we're not going to go backwards over that. But it is a case of reform is an important step. Term limits for officials, central integrity checks for executive committee members, and the disclosing of all salaries and payments to FIFA members will be the main focus of the reform task force, Blatter said, although he did not go into more detail. The setup of the committee would be like 10 players on a coach, he added, with one key person, the coach, driving the process. Jonathan Coachman? Anyway, no, I'm only kidding. But it is a case of, but also in relation to this reform and task force, Platini said the creation of the panel was an important step. Speaking after the FIFA executive committee meeting, he said, we must now make sure the reforms outlined today will be undertaken in a swift and effective manner. We need to reform FIFA and we need to do it now. Glass houses, stones. But anyway, Blatter believes the steps to reform could be his legacy. Sorry. He said, I am still the elected president by 133 associations and I will use my mandate as president in a responsibility and mission to make sure that at the end of February, I can say FIFA started to reform and rebuild the reputation of FIFA. Now, today's news conference, Monday 20th of July 2015, was used to announce the decisions of FIFA's executive committee. There was a little incident which we're going to go on to later on in the show, but basically it's a case of the extraordinary congress will come in February and the new president of FIFA will be voted for in February. So that's one of the important things, and of course this task force is important as well. Jesse Fizzle, I'm going to ask for your view first, and then if any of the Skypers want to jump in. But I know with this task force, I know what my mind thought of as soon as I saw that.
What, the Council of Wisdom?
Yeah, exactly. Jezzy, would you like to have your view on more fallout from the FIFA scandal?
Well, I think, you know, having these checks put in for high-level officials, so on and so forth. I mean, like, wasn't that what was supposed to happen anyway? Isn't that how things were supposed to be done anyway?
Yeah.
And you want to bring it in now? I'm not saying it's not a good thing, because let's really put things in perspective. It's taken everything else that's happened in order for this to happen. So in many ways, it's great, right? Because it's the start of something. But at the same time, right, I also appreciate the bit where a lot of people are probably thinking, gosh, man, did it really have to take all of this to get here? Was all of that really necessary? But as I said, you know, we have to look at it as, and you know, we talked about this at the start of the show in general talking points, it's a new beginning, right? A date has been set. We know when it's going down, much like the Jezzy Fizzle Sizzle tour. So, you know, for me, it's just a matter of time. And let's see what happens. In terms of Platini being urged and advised to go for the presidency of FIFA, here's the thing, right? I ask one question to those people that are recommending Platini, right? One question. Is UEFA, in its current guise, under Michel Platini, really the model that you want to follow?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, if it is, then fine. I can understand that, right? But for me personally, I'm like, is it really that much better than FIFA? Are they clamping down on, you know, any indiscretions against protocol at the moment? No. Are they taking a stand, a harsh stand, against any major issues at the moment? No. And you want the same guy that's in charge of that in charge of everything? I don't know. Personally, I don't know. So, you know, and that's not me being disrespectful to Michel Platini. I'm not. I'm just saying we really have to look at it in the sense of, if under his stewardship, right, if we were making some really big moves. So, for example, they already intervened in the cases of Ian Moody, Malky Mackay, and Emmanuel Frimpong, shall we say. Let's say they already looked into that. They already doled out punishment to the Russian FA. We're just talking about the stories that we're talking about now, right? They already intervened in those. I would say, okay, fine. You know, we need somebody who's on the ball like that, literally, to be running the whole show. But in the absence of all of that, so you're just going to get more of what you've already got.
Yeah. And that is my eternal fear. Because like I've said before, in regards to Michel Platini, it's a case of you better not throw stones whilst living in a glass house yourself. It's one of them ones. I reckon there's probably a lot to come out at UEFA in terms of obviously like match fixing, that kind of thing. There's been a lot of that happening under UEFA's jurisdiction that nothing's gone on with. I mean, remember, the Bretson's goalkeeper being involved in that as well. I mean, it's one of them ones. I mean, well, there's potentially another scandal in Italy happening that's kind of coming to light in bits and bobs and fits and starts. So it's one of them ones. But you know, like it is a case of like, okay, doing this thing with the reforms and that. All right, fine. But as you said, Jezzy, it shouldn't have taken all this for it to happen. It should have happened 10 to 15 years ago. It should have happened 20 years ago. But the fact is, at least it's happened. World Cup bidders to be banned from foreign investment.
To me, that's a no-brainer. To me, that see, once again, if it wasn't bad enough doing the two bids at once with 2018 and 2022, which went to Russia and Qatar respectively, if it wasn't bad enough doing that and not expecting collusion, you've also got this rule. You've also got a regulation with the existing clause, which mandates all countries wishing to stage the World Cup to pump money into the game outside their own borders. What kind of stupid, idiotic, moronic rule is that? And you're not expecting corruption or collusion with a stupid rule like that in place. But are you... the powers that be must be... Well, I've had my views on Blatter in the past before. But the powers that be must be really stupid to have that written in as a mandate. All countries wishing to stage the World Cup have to pump money into the game outside of their own borders. So essentially, if I'm England and I want Mexico's vote, I can just promise to put money into their infrastructure and give them 10 million and they'll vote for me. You see how stupid that mandate is? What? Oh, Christ almighty, that is just really stupid. So the fact that they've amended it, well done, lads. Well done, FIFA. You're a day late and a dollar short once again. At least you've done it, but the fact is, it's like the homegrown rule over here. Huge loophole, and it took you ages to close it. Idiots. But the Jeffrey Webb thing, yeah, mate, for me, if he gets found guilty, throw him under the jail. Throw him and the other 13, 14 officials arrested, throw them under the jail. Because they've disgraced the game. They've brought it into disrepute. And you know what? They've compromised the integrity of the game as well. Of the game we love, and that is football. Throw them people, kind of people, under the jail. Bugger them. Throw them under the jail. These reform plans and a task force. Like you said, Jezzy, I can't take it seriously. Because with FIFA, the Council of Wisdom was supposed to do exactly this same thing. And we've been calling for four or five years saying, no, don't get your friends to investigate you. Why not get Interpol involved? And ironically enough, with the current corruption investigation, now Interpol are involved about 4.5 years after we called for it.
Yeah, because I mean, I remember it's a pitch talk first point. And I said, you know, using the example of me, you and the G-Man, you know, the trifecta of GLG. But if, for example, that was going to be the case with us, and I was saying, right, well, you guys as my friends, you can investigate me, right? You can look here. But whatever you do, don't look over there.
Yeah. Well, Emma, right. You can stipulate the terms of the investigation.
This is it.
And your friends, friends ain't going to cross you.
This is what you're investigating. And I've already pre-prepared everything you need to know.
Yeah.
Right? Everything I don't want you to know, I'm not telling you.
Exactly.
Done.
It's legalized insanity. It truly is legalized insanity, which is why I said this whole thing that I find this funny. Sepp Blatter announcing term limits for presidents and integrity checks for top officials. That's why I had to laugh when I said that, because Sepp Blatter saying, yeah, we're going to introduce term limits for presidents and integrity checks. Okay, how about we start with you? I wouldn't be able to, if I was in that room, I wouldn't be able to take it seriously. I'd be like, well, okay, how about we start with you then? Let's see you with these integrity checks. Let's see if you come through with flying colors. And we're not letting Henry Kissinger do it or Placido Domingo, because they're part of the Council of Wisdom. We're not letting them do it. Let's let Interpol do it. Let's let the FBI do it. It's one of them ones. How much does this guy weigh? How much does his integrity weigh? It's one of them ones. But the whole thing with, yeah, there's not gonna be a new vote on FIFA president until February, you know, that will mean that Blatter will have served 9 months. He will have served literally almost a quarter of his term by the time that that vote comes around. Even though he said he was going to resign, he said in June he was looking to resign. Yeah. I just find it funny. Dude's still padding his own bed, even though apparently he's on his way out. So one of them was a Michel Platini. As you said, Chezzy, I'm in agreement with you. I don't know. I don't think Platini's the best candidate. Because as said, like I've said over the past year, for the last year or two, Platini has been burying Blatter because he wanted to take over. He wanted to take over at FIFA. And now it's almost a reality. Apparently he's got the backing of a load of confederations. It almost seems like Platini is actually assisting him in getting into that FIFA role potentially. Which I said doesn't surprise me. It really doesn't surprise me at all.
Well, no, and then the other thing you have to ask is where did all the support suddenly come from?
Yeah.
Right? Because last I checked, you know, Sepp Blatter had some pretty key regions on lock.
Yeah, Asia and Africa, like, especially. There was like that support,
unanimous support there.
Yeah.
So, has everybody suddenly decided to do a Fabian Delph?
No, you know what? I don't think so.
Is my first question. And my second question is it a matter of money talking?
You know what? Yeah, and BS walks. But anyway, rest in peace to Rick James on that one. But no, it's a case of, I reckon it's one of them ones. Let me throw a conspiracy theory out for a sec.
All right.
I think it's one of them ones where seeing as corruption is rampant within FIFA, and I think it's rampant within UEFA as well. It's just that it ain't come out yet.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing that there's all this collusion, and one minute guys are at each other's throats, next minute they're best friends, and vice versa.
Okay.
And the fact that Platini has been burying Blatter for a year or two now, in terms of trying to get to the FIFA presidency, I think it's one of them ones where Blatter has said, you know what, I'm on my way out, but you know what, I think you would be best. I think you, the African confederations and the Asian confederations, I think you would be best off supporting Michel Platini. I think you'd be better off doing that. Platini gets my blessing. I think that's what's going on here.
Mm.
Because the Asian and African confederations, one minute supporting Blatter, then next minute turning around and saying, yeah, we support Platini now. It looks suspicious to me.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was getting at. Yeah. Because I'm like, well, if there was such staunch support, and it's like, no, Sir Blatter did wonderful things for us, and that's why we'll always support him, and we'll tell everybody else in the region to support him. To now all of a sudden be like, bye, Blatter. I'm like, no. Something had to happen there.
Mm.
And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if there's not a money trail there. Right? Because when you look at it, okay, most African players play where?
In England, huh?
Central Europe.
Yeah.
Central Europe. If not France or Belgium, then England.
Yeah.
Right? Most Asian players play where? Some of them play in Germany.
Yeah.
Some in France. And very few in England. So, again, like, the whole thing, when you go in and look at it, it's like, Because to me, the biggest thing that's missing is some money to go in their pockets, right? So, all that had to happen is, and Michel Platini already said, look, if you happen to give me a gift of a watch, I'm not giving it back. It's a gift. Right? All he has to go and do is just, I don't know, put some money in some people's palms, told them, right, look the other way while I put this in your hand.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's it. Yeah. Like, it's really not overly complicated. And then the other thing as well is, essentially, with Sepp Blatter going and not being able to be in charge anymore because of the new terms and, you know, fit and proper persons kind of checks that they're going to do on senior officials now, right? Really, Michel Platini, he's the devil you know.
Because of that, I'd rather almost the devil I don't know have someone outside of that circle. I would rather someone outside of that circle come in and try and reform stuff, because at least it will potentially come from an honest position.
I agree with you wholeheartedly, but as I say, I think throwing my conspiracy theory hat on, that's what it is. It's like, well, okay, we know him. And if we follow your conspiracy theory and we say, well, he's essentially been given the blessing from the Godfather that is Sepp Blatter, then, as I say, everything's lined up nicely and neatly. Mm. You know, essentially, this isn't a resignation, it's an abdication. And it's the son that's now taking over.
Yeah.
If he's actually in charge, because here's the thing, it's an abdication. You're not really running the show.
Mm.
Okay. The king or queen is still the king or queen. You're just sitting in their seat. That's it.
I mean, this whole thing just frustrates me. I mean, at least there are a couple of positive things in this, but the fact of the matter is it's all stemmed from huge negativity that should never have been allowed to get that far anyway. And
I agree with you, I do, but I will pause and I will say this. Two things. First thing I say, as I say, regardless of all of that, this is still a new beginning. There is still a big positive in it. Okay? Irrespective. And I think it's important to remember that. The second thing that I will say is, look, sometimes, right, when it's really, really difficult to see what you need to do, okay, there needs to be that correction, that attitude adjustment, to paraphrase the WWE and John Cena's finisher name, right, where certain things happen and will keep happening until you actually wake up, smell the coffee in the morning, to again paraphrase Miguel's song title, and actually see what's going on, right, and actually do what's required in the situation to get past it. So, yeah, it may take, in this case, 10 to 15 years, or 4 or 5, or what have you, right? But the most important thing above everything else is that the lesson is learned. And I feel that, you know, a significant lesson has been learned here. Whether it's the only one to be learned is open to debate, because I think there's actually a heck of a lot more that can be done, should be done. And if, you know, we were in charge, for example, would be done. But at the same time, as I say, it's a new beginning because finally something is being done.
Yeah. I'll go with that. I mean, Jaymie Bailey, did you want to jump in on this point before we move on? Oh, Jaymie, you there? Yeah.
Senior Bailey.
Oh, yeah, Jaymie.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yep, can hear you. You want to jump in on this point?
Like you said, I find this a little hilarious as well. But I don't find it as hilarious as how it could be, with Sepp Blatter being given a second chance at, in his words, redemption. Mm. It's like, if you see how the WWE's sort of been run. Obviously, you haven't watched it for quite a few years, Liam, but it's almost a case of the Good Boy Network is still going forward there as well as it is here.
Well, bear in mind, I saw WCW. I used to watch WCW. So in terms of the good old boys, you don't get much worse than that. And that business was going down. So that was...
Well, the only reason why this will stand to any attention, and I just feel that within, even by the time Wembley's even paid off, the stadium itself is paid off, football ain't gonna be anything.
But sticking on the FIFA thing though, before we have to move on. But what do you reckon in terms of the FIFA?
That's what I'm saying. In terms of the FIFA thing, that's where it's going. I feel like it's gonna ruin football to that point. I couldn't care less what happens now. We're going to get a new president, and it's quite ironic that the president is the voting happens in February. Same month as my birthday. All of a sudden, we've got a presidency to work on. Really? Now? You couldn't do it now? Oh, wait, hold on. I've got a few rules to make before I leave, and possibly get a few countries to sort of turn their back on FIFA and make a few more problems. For me, it just seems like it's going to become an issue. So, I just have a problem with that at the moment. I think that's what it's going to come up. It's going to come back to haunt whoever comes in next, and whatever happens next is probably going to destroy football for good.
Well, you know what? It is a case of, though, whoever does come in next is going to have to carry on the salvage job. And this salvage job, we're talking decades in terms of damaged images, damaged credibility. It's going to take decades to sort this crap out. I said, for me personally, to weed all the corruption out of football, you have to stop the game completely and weed it out. You really have to. But football's too much of a cash cow to do that. And for me, that's the jack. But hey, we're gonna move on in a second, because we got someone who, even though it was a prank, it was a pretty interesting way of protesting. So you know what? You know, it is one of them ones where it is about that time. A nice one for those views as well, Jaymie Bailey. I mean, it's hard not to go full CWO, aka Cynic World Order, on the FIFA reforms. For me, actions speak louder than words. FIFA can say all they want about wanting to reform. Let's see him actually do it. Let's see him do it this time. But you know what? It is about that time for the final segment of the show, which is... We've been waiting to go over this one for the whole show. North Korea 2026. Monday's FIFA news conference to announce the decisions of FIFA's executive committee began in dramatic fashion. The start was interrupted by British comedian Simon Brodkin. Brodkin, better known by his alter ego Lee Nelson, appeared to offer piles of banknotes to Blatter before security intervened. As he was led away, Brodkin threw the notes at Blatter, saying, "Here you go, Sepp." He later took to social media under the guise of another character, footballer Jason Bent, to declare, excited to be at FIFA, meeting Sepp Blatter to secure the North Korea 2026 World Cup. Now, as we tweeted out earlier, it's a very interesting way of protesting and getting yourself noticed. But there is an underlying seriousness. And that underlying seriousness, hey, bribery, corruption. I love it. I mean, personally, I found it hilarious. The way Simon Brodkin, aka Lee Nelson, did it. It was just one of them when he's getting led away. It gave me flashbacks. I think it was like 2005, where Matt Hardy attacked Edge on Raw and it was getting led out. And it was like Matt Hardy's like ROH as he's getting led out, and he was still on the contract with WWE. But anyway, leaving that aside, but it was one of them was. It gave me flashbacks of that, because the way Simon Brodkin did it. Firstly, you gotta wonder how he got through and how he got that far, because in theory he could have punched that Blatter in the face, and the football world would have thanked him for it. But in theory he could have assaulted Blatter. He got close enough to drop like a fat wad of notes right on the table where Sepp Blatter was, and Blatter's like, huh? He had that confused look on his face, as usual. But it's one of them ones where it was actually hilarious. If you can watch the footage, go watch it. But I think as a protest, it's actually genius. But it does make you worry about security. But Jazzy Fizzle, your view?
Well, it just goes to show the level of security. first and foremost.
Or lack thereof.
Well, this is my point, right? And then, of course, the counterbalance to all this, well, it just goes to show how much of a joke as an establishment they are, because, well, that kind of thing was allowed. Here's the thing. If you're really taking yourself seriously, nobody gets near the table. Table's sacrosanct. It's as simple as that.
Of course. Lee Nelson's impromptu invasion doesn't happen.
This is it. Right. But Lee Nelson's putting himself about now. Wasn't he on stage with Kanye West at Glastonbury?
I think so, but I didn't pay any attention to that, to be honest.
Right. So he goes and interrupts the greatest rock and roll star alive, according to Kanye West. I'm not quite so sure about that.
That guy's a legend. Say, in his own mouth.
One of, you know, the best rappers and producers of, say, the 2000s and the 2010s, I would argue. Yeah, pretty much. But greatest rock and roll star, no.
He's not rock and roll at all. The guy's a moron. But Lee Nelson.
I don't know. But Lee Nelson, as I say, he's putting himself about. And I think in terms of his own publicity, fantastic. But in terms of football, I have to say, I'm really not so sure.
It was funny, but it's another slap in the face to the game.
Yeah, this is what I mean. In the sense of, yeah, it was amusing, but what does it actually do? What does it mean? What does it stand for? Is my question. Right? If it was to raise awareness of the fact that, for example, money is being wasted in some of these quote-unquote projects in these developing countries, football in terms, shall we say, not necessarily economic terms or social terms, then okay. Right? Like, that's a good move. But if it's not anything to do with that, then I ask the question, what's it enabled? What is it trying to prove?
Yeah,
you know? And as I said, if you don't stand for something, you fall for anything. So.
Yeah. Nah, I hear that. I mean, it is one of them ones. The Skypers have been waiting to jump in on this. Or Jaymie Bailey, you want to have a quick run at this?
Yeah, I actually find it hilarious that he'd done it. But I'll say it in the way that you guys have kind of presented me for the last few weeks since the FA Cup final. Yeah. That turn of pace has come through for Tepner. Finally. But you know what? Yeah, I'm going to let the show continue. I think that was hilarious. That was one hilarious situation. The only other thing that it didn't do is wow the crowds, considering that they seem to be shocked as well. Yeah. And the fact that they're in a FIFA conference, they shouldn't be shocked by anything that Sepp does or whatever or somebody does do. So,
well, unless Blatter falls over again. Oh, that's one funny.
Well, that's hilarious. That was hilarious. As I said, yeah.
it's like throwing money at that. No, but no. Kieran Riley, you wanted to jump in as well, didn't you?
Yeah, I was at work when my mate texted me about this, and I looked at the video. I thought this was absolutely hilarious. And yeah, Jesse, you were right. He did gatecrash Chris Brown's performance at Glastonbury. But yeah, sorry.
What do you mean Kanye West?
Kanye West, sorry.
last time I checked, Chris Brown was not a Glastonbury.
I found it hilarious. And another thing Sepp Blatter's done is he said in a statement, if you've read it before, anyone who thinks FIFA is corrupt or he is corrupt should be sent to prison.
We went over that a couple of weeks back, and we had a good old chuckle at that one. Yeah, because I'm probably most at risk for that, and I think most of the other Skypers as well. Yeah, we would be in a lot of trouble. Oh, that was, oh.
Yeah, I mean, fair play to what he did. It was actually quite fun in the moment. He actually got managed to even get in that press conference.
Yeah, no, that. Well, as I said, that's the concern about security. Right. It's one of them, but I love that. Tom Wood said, imagine Mr. Bean invading one of Sepp Blatter's press conferences. Sorry. Hello, Sepp. I am brain. My name is. You can only imagine. Oh, man. It would be one of them was. Yeah, I would prefer Dwayne The Rock Johnson to do it. It's like, hey, Seth. Hey, excuse me, sir. Just walk up to the table. Excuse me, sir. What is your name? My name is. It doesn't matter what your name is. or it'd be one of them ones. Reforms? What are your reforms? Well, my reforms. It doesn't matter what your reforms are. One of them was tonight. I am Seb Blatter. And for the next 20 minutes, I will be doing and saying absolutely nothing. Someone would have said, imagine Alan Sugar walks in and says, you're fired. Now, for me, I wouldn't use Alan Sugar. I'd use Vinnie Mac. I'd use Vinnie Mac. Excuse me, Seb. You're fired. Oh, well, that was, man. But, you gotta give props to Simon Brodkin, aka Lee Nelson, though. I mean, it was funny, but it's one of them ones, man. The running joke that is FIFA, getting pranked like that. One of them ones. Can't do anything but laugh. But you know what? It is about that time for us to start making some moves, because the show is pretty much that time.
Hi, I'm John Sutton, and I'm here with Gavin, Liam, and Gerald on Pitch Talk.
The football talk show that pulls no punches and holds back nothing on opinions.
Hello, I'm Rob Burris.
My name is Christian Carambeau.
I'm grassroots coach Manisha Taylor.
Hi, I'm Matt Hodgson, director of the 4-year plan, and you're listening to Pitch Talk, the only place to get your Monday night footballing fix.
Make sure you join the revolution.
The pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And the pitch is where we talk.
I'm Andy Copeland from the Glenmet Southern Amateur League.
Philip Wick, I'm CEO of 14.
Rob Lusher, former chairman of Ibis FC.
I'm Tamir Swaney, co-founder and co-director of Motivate Sports and Fitness.
And you're listening.
And you're listening to Pitch Talk.
Out of nowhere. you'd almost hope that someone would do to Sepp Blatter at that press conference what Miguel did to that one at the Billboard Awards in 2013. Wham! Oh, the whole thing dropped. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, straight shooting LJ, the G-Man, the Chelsea Fizzle, proudly bring to you the football talk show that pulls no punches and holds back nothing on opinions. Why? Because the pitch is where we eat.
The pitch is where we sleep.
And, of course, the pitch is where we talk. Well, we've got another fun show with a lot of debate. Crowbar, a lot of debate in. We'd like to thank all of the silent listeners, all of those listening back on the podcast, on iTunes, Mixcloud, Automatic Spreaker, and TuneIn Radio as well. People,
J Productions.
Yeah, definitely. People on those pages, Mixcloud, iTunes, Automatic Spreaker, and TuneIn Radio, give us a rating, give us a review. We'd love to see it. And of course, it helps the algorithms and helps jump us up a bit so we can keep progressing and keep making your Monday night footballing fix that bit better. Give us an iTunes review, a Mixcloud review, Podomatic, everywhere. Give us a review everywhere. So one of them was give us a review, spread the word, and everything as well. Remember, Pitch Talk meets Darrell David is coming soon as well. Get your questions in to pitchtalk@gmail.com with Darrell David in the subject line. Also, youtube.com/pitchtalk. Pitch Talk on the road at Hackney Wick FC will be coming soon. So keep your eyes peeled for that one. Also, big time shout outs to at Beautiful Game on Twitter and Two Men in Search of the Beautiful Game, Daniel and Tom. Big shout outs to Hackney Wick FC at Hackney Wick FC on Twitter and Hackney Wick FC on Facebook. Also, my word, facebook.com/pitchtalk, become a member of the group, join the footballing revolution we are working so hard to create. pitchtalk.blogspot.co.uk or .com will get you to the blogs by yours truly, Straight Shooting LJA, and
G-Man and Jersey Fizzle and many others as well. 0753580446 is the mobile number. Call us, text us, let us know your views. If you text, leave your name at the end of the text. Also, youtube.com/pitstalk is where you'll find all of our videos, including Pitstalk Rants of the Week, Push Points, Cup Final videos, Pitstalk Meets. Remember, we'll be at the Women's FA Cup Final on August 1st. We're bringing the cameras down, so come and find us, baby. And we'll be doing a Pitstalk at the Cup Final video there as well. Also, my word, so many video series, so little time. The Push Points, the Rants of the Week, Pitstalk Meets, the Cup Final series, and the PT on the Road series, which we'll be soon adding to as well. There are also big time. Oh my God, at Pitstalk on Twitter. Tweet with us, follow us, see what we're up to. Pitstalk Live on Google Plus as well. It is one of them most many ways to get in touch with us. Many, many, many ways. Noah, I have been straight shooting LJA.
And as always, I've been Jezzy. The sizzle fizzle. The sizzle.
Now, now it's in your mouth there, baby. Oh, and the G-Man sends his regards as well, as he couldn't make the show today. Big time shout outs to Motivate Sports and Fitness. Big shout outs to Kells on the Ball. Beautiful game. Sorry, Two Men in Search of a Beautiful Game, Hackney Wick FC, Ibis FC as well, Parkgate FC too. Big shout outs to them.
And don't forget Football Beyond Borders.
Of course, of course. Big shout outs to Football Beyond Borders and Football Beyond Borders Warriors as well. One of them was, it's been tremendo. So we've enjoyed having your company tonight. Hopefully you've enjoyed ours. I remember, spread that word. We need the reviews. iTunes, Mixcloud, Podomatic, Spreaker, and TuneIn Radio. We need them reviews. We need the spreading of the word. We need the sharing of the videos and everything. Give us a review.
And who knows? If you give us a good review, there might be a Jezzy Fizzle Sizzle Talk coming to a neighborhood near you.
Exactly. It is one of them ones. But once again, I have been straight shooting LJ.
I've been Jezzy the Sizzle Fizzle.
And on behalf of the G-Man too, we say thank you very much, everybody. Good night.